Welcome to another episode of the British Comedy Radio Channel. This is episode number 2.
Oh my God. I've hit the flying doctor. Can you do first aid?
First up, we have a really good show called A Proper Charlie, starring Jack Smethurst as Charlie Garside with David Ross, Madge Hindle, Betty Alberge, John Jardine, Charles Collingwood, Jane Hayes Legrove, and Jason Littler.
We present Jack Smethurst as Charlie Garside in A Proper Charlie by Vince Powell.
Hello, Charlie.
Evening, Chaffee.
I saw you sitting here when I came in, so I took the liberty of getting you another drink.
You can take that liberty with me any time you like, son.
Hello, Chaffee. Hello, Charlie. Hello, Chaffee.
Here he is, the human minor bird. Where have you been, Cyril?
I've just come from the doctor's. I've just come from the doctor's.
Well, what did he say?
He told me to take all my clothes off. He told me to take all my clothes off.
Perhaps he wanted a good laugh.
he was very thorough. He was very thorough. He looked in me eyes, in me mouth, and up me nose. He looked in me eyes, in me mouth, up me nose.
Did he find any evidence that you were human?
And he listened to me chest and me heart. He listened to me chest and me heart. And he said I was 100% fit. I'm 100% fit.
What complaint did you go with?
I didn't have a complaint. I didn't have a complaint.
Well, why did you go to the doctor's?
To pick up my mother's prescription.
Now, just for that, you can go and get the drinks.
Oh, righto, Charlie, righto, Charlie. What do you want? Well, what do you want?
A pint will do me.
I might have a short.
Do they have short pints? do they have short pints?
I mean a drop of the hard stuff. A gold watch.
You can't buy a watch here. You can't buy a watch here.
Charlie was using rhyming slang. You know, like Dickie Dirt and Rosie Lee.
Do they speak like that, then? do they speak like that?
Who?
This Dickie Dirt and Rosie Lee.
I should have just asked for a scotch.
Rhyming slang is using words that rhyme with another word.
Like Jack the Dandy. Brandy.
Pig's ear. Beer.
Brahms and Liszt. Drunk.
Hey, just a minute, Brahms and Liszt doesn't rhyme with drunk. Brahms and Liszt. I see what you mean.
Oh, come on, Cyril. Get the drinks in, Obi. That's closing time in a minute.
Righto, righto.
Can you remember what you're going for?
Oh, yes. A gold clock and a pig's trotter.
He doesn't improve with age?
No. He's been daft all his life.
How long have you known Cyril?
Ever since he was a little girl.
A little girl?
Yes. You see, his mother had always wanted a girl. So when Cyril came along, she used to dress him up in girls' clothes. He only found out he was a boy at nursery school. He was playing that game, you know. I'll show you mine if you show me yours. He never got over the shock.
Well, that explains a lot. What he needs is a good woman.
Not even a bad one. No. You're right there, Tam. You're quite right. He needs a wife.
You can have mine.
Here you are, lads. here you are, lads.
Well, we're just saying, Cyril. It's time you thought about having a wife.
Oh, no, I'm saving myself for the right woman. I'm saving myself for the right woman.
You save yourself much longer, you'll have gone off.
Have you ever been in love, Cyril?
Yes, I have. I say I have.
Oh, come on, Cyril. Tell us more, Cyril.
Oh, well, she didn't know I existed.
Neither do we at times.
I worshipped her from afar. I say I worshipped her from afar.
Sounds a funny sort of romance to me.
Well, hers was the first face I saw when I woke up.
You randy old devil.
No, I had her picture by me bed. I say I had her picture by me bed. To Cyril, with love, it said. It said, to Cyril, with love.
Did she know that you worshipped her from afar?
Oh, yes, I wrote to her. I say, I wrote to her.
Didn't you ever meet her?
No. My mother wouldn't let me. I say, my mother wouldn't let me.
Oh, afraid of being left on her own, eh?
No, it wasn't that. It wasn't that. She wouldn't lend me the money for the fare. I say, she wouldn't lend me the money for the fare.
Couldn't you walk it?
What, to Los Angeles? I said, to Los Angeles.
Hang on. Who was this secret sweetheart of yours?
Alice Faye. I say, Alice Faye.
You know, Taffy, if there are tax on brains, he'd be due for a rebate.
Well, if you two will excuse me, I must be off.
Hang on, Taffy, I'm coming with you. I say, I'm coming with you.
Hey, what are you dashing off for?
Well, I want to have an early night. I want to have an early night.
Don't you want another drink?
No. Too much alcohol makes me dream. I say, it makes me dream. You know, last night I dreamt I was in a sauna bath with Shirley MacLaine. I say, Shirley MacLaine. And Jane Fonda. And Bo Derek. I say, Bo Derek. It was terrible. It was terrible.
What was terrible about it?
I was Raquel Welch.
Mum?
Yes, Terry?
Can I ask you a favour?
How much do you want to borrow?
£1.
And how are you going to pay me back?
2p a week.
2p a week? At that rate, it'll take you a year.
Well, I'm not going anywhere.
You're always borrowing money.
Well, I wouldn't have to if you put me spend up. It's time I had a rise.
You've got a clout round the ear hole if you don't watch out.
My spend should be an index link to the cost of living.
You've been watching Panorama again.
I could withdraw my labour.
You're joking. You didn't do anything, no.
Are you going to lend me £1?
No! You'll have to ask your dad.
Well, I can't.
Why not?
I already owe him £1.
Hello, Mum. I hope it's Return of the Jedi.
Shut your face.
That'll do you too. Go and see who that is, Terry.
Well, I will if you lend me £1.
Don't be so cheeky. Go on.
Oh, all right.
You're late, Linda?
We were stopped taking.
Are you settling down now in your new job?
Yeah, it's all right.
I mean, you're lucky to have a job. I know it's only a shoe shop, but there's plenty of people who'd be glad of it.
It's not bad, I suppose. Apart from the boss, Mr. Gropey.
I thought your boss was called Mr. Grimshaw.
He is.
Well, why do you call him Mr. Gropey? Oh, I see what you mean.
Auntie Ivy.
Hello, Vera. Hello, Linda.
Hello, Auntie Ivy. How's Uncle Walter?
It could be a lot worse.
Good.
His memory's going, you know.
I am sorry.
Well, you can tell. He was over an hour in the bathroom this morning trying to find where he'd put it.
Pardon?
And all the time he had it in his hands.
Get away.
I said, if you're going to carry on like this every morning, we'll have to tie a piece of string to it.
What are you talking about?
His toothbrush.
Poor Uncle Walter.
He needs cheering up.
I'll pop round and see him later.
He said he needs cheering up.
Don't be so cheeky.
Do you think you children can go in the other room? I want to speak to your mother, personal-like.
Well, I've got to get ready to go out anyway.
And you've got your own work to finish, Terry.
No.
What is it, Ivy? Is it your Walter?
No. It's all the other men.
What other men?
They keep making suggestive remarks.
How do you mean?
Well, it started yesterday with the window cleaner. He knocked on the back door and asked if he could fill his buckets.
That's perfectly innocent.
Not the way he said it. And he was squeezing his chamois at the same time.
I think you're imagining things, Ivy.
Well, what about the milkman?
What about the milkman?
He asked me if I wanted an extra red top. Then he tried to tempt me with a raspberry yoghurt.
It's all in your mind, Ivy.
That's not all.
Go on.
Last night I had one of them phone calls.
Was it obscene?
He didn't give his name.
I mean, was it just heavy breathing?
No, he spoke.
Oh, they're the worst. What did he say?
He said he bet I was a bit of hot stuff and he'd like to make passionate love to me.
The cheeky thing!
Then he hung up when he heard what I had to say.
Did you tell him you'd call the police?
No, I asked him for his address.
Call the name up! Oh, hello, Ivy.
Hello, Charlie. I'm just going.
Don't go on my account, Ivy.
I'd best get back. I don't like leaving him on his own too long. He tends to wander about.
Well, a little wander won't do him any harm.
When I got back from the shops this lunchtime, I found him wandering up the road.
I bet that surprised the neighbours.
It did. He'd forgotten to put his trousers on.
Come on, Ivy. I'll see you out.
Ta-ra, Charlie.
Ta-ra, Ivy.
Hello, Dad.
Hello, son.
Are you in a good mood?
Not if you want to borrow money, I'm not.
Well, I just want to borrow a pound.
A pound? You already owe me a pound from last week.
Well, I'll tell you what. Have you got a pound note?
Yes.
Just lend it me for a minute.
Here we go again. Here you are, then.
Right. Now, you say I owe you a pound from last week.
That's right.
So, if I give you this pound, that makes us straight, OK?
I think so.
So, if you give me that pound back, I only owe you a pound, right?
It sounds right, but I've got a feeling I've lost a pound somewhere.
Hello, Dad. Ta-ra, Dad.
Yeah, hang on, hang on. Where do you think you're going?
Out.
Oh, aye, and what time will you be back?
When I get in.
No, that's the bless of your lip. Who are you going out with?
Marvin.
Marvin. And what sort of a name is that?
It's a screw.
Pardon?
Marvin and the Screws, that's his group. Oh, the Dead Fab.
Yes, I know the sort. Long hair, sequins and tight trousers.
That's right. Marvin's trousers are so tight you'd swear they were painted on.
They should ban that sort of thing, you know. It's indecent, immoral and downright vulgar.
Try telling that to Rudolf Nureyev.
Hello, Linda.
Ta-ra, ma'am.
You know, I worry about that girl.
It's your son you should worry about.
I think I'll go out on me back.
You'll stay just where you are.
Oh, then what's he been doing now?
Well, while I was seeing our Ivy out, one of his teachers was coming up the path to ask how Terry was.
What does he mean?
Apparently, he hasn't been at school for 2 days.
Of course he's been at school. We've seen him go out every morning.
He may have left here, but he's never got to school.
Is this true, Terry?
Yes, Dad.
You've been playing truant?
Yes, Dad.
Why?
Well, it's Jumbo.
Jumbo? You mean you've got an elephant at your school?
No, Jumbo Johnson. He's in our class and he keeps picking on me. He calls me Tattyhead.
Well, why don't you punch him on the nose?
Because he's bigger than me.
Well, punch him in the stomach then.
I don't like violence.
Our Terry's a good boy. He doesn't go in for fighting.
You're a Garside. All those Garsides are good fighters.
What about your Uncle Percy in the war?
He was in the army.
He was a deserter.
He was suffering from shell shock.
What, at Aldershot?
Anyway, he was on my mother's side. My dad's side of the family are different. Terry, I want you to go to this school tomorrow and give this Jumbo a bunch of fives.
I'm no good at fighting, Dad.
Right. Well, I'll teach you.
I don't want you teaching Terry to be a hooligan.
He's got to learn how to defend himself. Put your hands up, Terry.
Like this?
Yes, that's it. Now, I'll show you how to avoid being hit. Try and belt me on the chin.
Well, Well, I don't...
Cut it, it's all right, son. You won't hit me. You see, when you throw the punch, I'll faint.
Typical.
Not faint, faint. Faint. F-E-I-N-T. One of the elementary rules of the art of boxing. Dodge from side to side to avoid being thumped.
Pardon me, Frank Bruno.
Right. Come on, Terry. Belt me one.
Well, I might hurt you.
You won't hurt me. You won't even touch me. Now, come on. Come on. Try and give me a right hook on the chin as hard as you can.
All right, Dad.
Oh, Dad! Oh!
I think you've knocked your dad out.
Are you all right, Dad?
I told you to be your right, not your left.
Well, I thought I'd surprise you.
You certainly did that.
It was a lucky punch.
Are you going to teach me some more, Dad?
No, son. I think we've had enough for one day.
And you're going to school tomorrow?
I'm not. Jumbo Johnson will start bullying me again.
I've told you, you're a Garside. Belting one.
It's all right, Terry. That boy won't pick on you again.
Why not?
Because your dad is going round to see his dad and tell him to stop his boy picking on you.
That's right. Your dad... Pardon?
You heard.
Yeah, what if his dad won't listen to me? Then what do I do?
You're a Garside. Belt him one.
Are you sure this is the house?
Yes, Dad. Number 29.
Right. You wait here.
Oh, no, I'll come with you. I want to hear you have a go at him.
I'm only going to talk to him.
Oh, I thought you were going to bash him.
Jaw, jaw is better than war, war. Come on. Terry, what's his dad like? Is he a big fella?
I don't know. You'll soon find out.
Yes, well, I've been thinking, son. But perhaps I should write him a letter.
You're not frightened, are you?
Me? No, of course I'm not.
Well, knock on the door, then.
Yes, I will. Oh, well, there's nobody in. Come on.
He probably didn't hear you. I'll knock. Hi, Mr. Johnson. Are you in there, Mr. Johnson? I think he'll have heard that.
I should think they've heard it in the Isle of Man.
Oh, not today, thanks.
Well, he's obviously busy, so we'll come back another time.
You're not afraid of him, are you, Dad?
I'm not afraid of anybody.
It was only a little fella.
Yes, he was, wasn't he?
The very thing.
That's right. Move away, son. Hey, Johnson! Come out and show yourself.
Oh, you are persistent.
Are you Mr. Johnson?
Yes, that's right. But you can call me Rodney. What do you want?
It's about your Dumbo.
Dumbo?
He means Jumbo.
Oh, dear, is he in trouble again?
Up to his eyebrows. Now, you tell him to stop picking on my boy.
Well, I can't do that.
You tell him, or I'll smash your face in.
Oh. You are aggressive.
You see these hands? They're trained killers.
Now, don't be like that.
If your son picks on my son again, I'll come round here and separate you from your breath.
He's not my son.
And another thing.
Pardon? I'm his uncle. You'd better speak to his father. Bert!
What's all the trouble here, Rodney?
This gentleman wants to speak to you.
Oh, yeah? Speak.
Well, it's not...
You heard what I said. Speak.
Yeah, no,
It'll do tomorrow.
I'd rather you tell me today.
Yes, well, it's about your son, Dumbo. I mean, Jumbo.
What about him?
Would you ask him to stop picking on my boy?
You what?
Please?
You can just push off.
Yes, we're just going anyway.
Don't you dare speak to my dad like that, or he'll smash your face in.
Teddy, son.
He's not scared of you.
Is that so?
Yeah, well, we'll be off now then.
Just a minute, you. Come here.
Get off! Get up! You're choking me!
Hey, you want to watch yourself there, mister? My dad's hands are trained killers.
I'm frightened to death, son.
You see, Danny's frightened of you.
Did you come here looking for a punch-up?
Yes, he did.
Teddy!
All right. You're on. You want a punch-up, you'll get a punch-up.
Good.
Perhaps we can talk this over.
Sunday morning, 10 o'clock. In the park.
He'll be there.
He'd better be.
Well, we did it, Dad.
Yes, you certainly did.
Coming.
Hello, Vera.
Come in, Ivy.
It is today, isn't it? The big fight.
Yes.
Only I thought I'd call and wish Charlie the best of luck. I might never see him again.
Don't say that to him. He's worried enough already. Come on in and join the crowd.
Crowd?
Yes. Cyril and Taffy are here. It's Ivy.
Oh, hello, Ivy. We thought it was Charlie.
He's not gone already, has he?
Oh, no, him and Terry are out jogging. I say they're out jogging.
We're back.
Where's Dad?
He's just come in.
Are you all right?
I'll be all right in a minute, love. Ooh, just let me get my breath back.
Shall I give you the kiss of life?
No, thanks, Ivy. No.
Yeah. You can give me the kiss of life. I say you can give me the kiss of life.
What? I think I've overdone the jogging.
How many miles did you do?
Nearly one.
You're out of condition, Boyle.
It won't be long now. I say it won't be long now.
Do you think you should go through with this, Charlie?
A man's got to do what a man's got to do.
You're not nervous, Dad, are you?
Nervous? Me? Never.
You'd better be going, then.
Don't rush me.
I thought you said you weren't nervous.
I'm not.
Then why are you shaking?
Well, it's cold in here.
I wish you wouldn't go through with it, Dad.
Well, you could always take an early dive. I say, you could always take an early dive.
I'm going fighting, not swimming.
If he hits you first, fall down and pretend you're unconscious.
If Mr. Johnson hits Dad's, he won't have to pretend.
Can't you go to arbitration?
No! A man's got to do what a man's got to do.
You're quite right. Besides, there's money involved.
And besides, it... Money?
I started a book at the Lion and Lamb. I bet a fiver.
You've put money on the fight?
Why not? It's a cast-iron certainty.
Well, at least somebody's got faith in me. Thank you, Taffy. I won't let you down. I'll knock Johnson's block off.
I hope not. I backed him to win. Yeah.
Thanks for nothing.
Well, it's time you went, Dad.
You going then, Charlie?
Yes, love. A man's got to do what a man's got to do.
Very true.
The moving finger writes.
Absolutely. I say absolutely.
He who hesitates is lost.
Definitely.
Or to put it another way, a man's got to do...
You've said that.
Oh, yes, sure.
Are you sure you don't want us to come with you?
No, love. I'd rather do this on my own.
Good luck, Charlie.
Thanks, Taffy.
All the best. I say all the best.
Thank you, Cyril.
It's been nice knowing you, Charlie.
Don't mention it, Ivy.
Ta-ra, Dad. Built him one for me.
I'll do my best, son.
Take care, Dad.
Come on, Linda. What are you crying for?
I don't want to see you get hurt.
Well, it's just possible I might hurt him.
Charlie's right. We should be giving him encouragement. He's very brave, and I, for one, have great faith in his abilities.
Thank you, Vera.
There's just one thing before you go, Charlie.
What's that, love?
You will let us know which hospital they take you to.
He's late, Bert.
I knew he wouldn't come.
No, you're wrong. Here he is now.
I didn't think you'd show up.
Aye. Well, you were wrong.
Come on, then.
You come on, then.
Right. You asked for it.
Bert!
Oh, well. It's the wife. Hello, Agnes, love.
Go to Agnes, me. What are you playing at?
Nothing, my love.
Zaya, what have I told you about brawling? Come on home. This very minute.
Yes, my pet.
A good job you came along there, missus. I was just about to knock his block off.
Why, you?
Agnes! Agnes! He's brawling again.
Again, Dad?
Well, you see, first, I hit him with me right. Then when he got up, I hit him with me left.
Then you really gave it to him then, Dad?
Oh, he was begging for mercy, love.
Ooh, I wish I could have been there.
No, it wasn't a pretty sight.
Oh, congratulations, Charlie. I didn't think you had it in you.
Oh, was nothing, love.
Can we come and watch you next time?
There's not going to be a next time.
Oh, yes, there is.
Pardon?
Well, while you was out fighting Mr. Johnson, I went out to play football, and that David Williams fouled me, so I kicked him in the ankle. And his dad's coming on to sort you out.
Oh, no!
Oh, dear. Your dad's gone and done that elementary rule of the art of boxing.
What's that, ma'am?
He's fainted.
You've been listening to A Proper Charlie by Vince Powell, with Jack Smethurst as Charlie, David Ross as Cyril, and John Jardine as Taffy. Vera was played by Madge Hindle and Ivy by Betty Alberge. Jane Hazelgrove and Jason Littler were Linda and Terry, and Rodney and Bert were played by Charles Collingwood. A Proper Charlie is produced in Manchester by Mike Craig.
And Jack Smethurst will be back in A Proper Charlie at the same time next week.
Twinspin now!
Two great tunes. First George Formby with A Lad from Lancashire, then Ivor Biggun with A Wanker with White Sox.
No matter where I go, London, Paris, Mexico, anywhere on earth, they know my place of birth. I met a girl from London when she sat on Blackpool Pier. She said, but tell, I'm a lad from Lancashire. She said, are you a nudist? So I blushed and said, no fear, I'm covered up like a lad from Lancashire. North or south, when I open my mouth, they know that I'm not Dutch. They can tell I come from Lancashire, but they can't tell me much. I whispered I'll be nudist if you'll be the same, my dear. She said, no fear, with a lad from Lancashire. A widow, nice and young and gay, said, come to tea, my dear. I served thing nice for a lad from Lancashire. We sat down on the sofa and I felt her creeping near. I said, hee-hee, take care, I'm a lad from Lancashire. North or south, when I open my mouth, they know that I'm not Dutch. They can tell I come from Lancashire, but they can't tell me much. that widow started kissing me and tickling me ear, I tickled her like a lad from Lancashire. I went with Jane down Lover's Lane and whispered in her ear, now do your best for a lad from Lancashire. She said to me, when on my knee, you can't do that, dear ear. I said, I can't, I'm a lad from Lancashire. North or south, when I open my mouth, they know that I'm not Dutch. They can tell I come from Lancashire, but they can't tell me much. That night when Jane got home again, her ma said, you look queer. I'll bet there's been with that lad from Lancashire.
Socks and wears them with pride. He looks such a wanker with his red and blue stripes. He buys 7 pairs, they cost him a quid. He looks such a wanker, the white socks all get. I see white socks, where? Right over there. Look over there, right there. A wanker with white socks on. Everyone's there, can you see any more anywhere? White socks are alright if you're playing sport. Not on your holidays when your trousers are short. So take off your white socks and throw them at me. And you'll become trendy wearing no socks like me. I see white socks, where? Right over there. Look over there, right there. A wanker with white socks on. Everyone's there, can you see any more anywhere? White socks show the world that you've no idea about trendy dressing or how to drink beer. Train spotters wear white socks or kids with big spots or big grown-up men with little tiny cocks. I see white socks, where? Right over there. Look over there, right there. A wanker with white socks on. Everyone's there, can you see any more anywhere? Men with white socks never have a chick. What kind of chick goes out with a prick? Do yourself a favor and save up your dough to buy a dark pair so we cannot go. I see white socks, where? Right over there. Look over there, right there. A wanker with white socks on. Everyone's there, can you see any more anywhere? Oh yeah, white socks. Oh yeah, white socks. White socks. White socks.
Stop Messing About was a BBC radio series broadcast in 1969 and 1970. Forced by circumstance into being a follow-up to Round the Horn, it retained a number of key talents from the previous show, with Kenneth Williams as the new show's main star. The sudden death of Round the Horn star Kenneth Horn at the end of Series 4 prompted a rewrite of the material intended for Series 5, which then found its way into Stop Messing About, alongside new sketches. Round the Horn writers Johnny Mortimer and Brian Cook are therefore credited with Series 1 of Stop Messing About, while Series 2, which was entirely original, was written by Miles Rudge.
Hold! Hold hard, I say! Your money or your life! 'Tis I, Jack Shepherd, who holds these pistols at your breast. Hold, I say, hold, for I would board thee.
I'm sorry, man, we're full up inside. There's another one behind.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present Kenneth Williams, Hugh Paddock, and Joan Sims in...
Stop messing about.
People of the world, this is the voice of Kenneth Williams the First. Shut up. Speaking to you from a sandbagged chaise longue somewhere west of Basingstoke. Last night I sent my forces to seize control of the Houses of Parliament, the BBC and the Tufnell Park slipper baths.
Well, they give you a lovely rub down for ninepence.
My demands are simple, and I expect the present Prime Minister to satisfy them in full. Yes, remember. Remember, my ultimate deterrent is poised over your head.
There's a frightening thought. What is he doing, Joe?
Well, I don't know, do I?
I'm starting a popular movement.
Yes. Joe, how long has this been going on?
Well, since last week. Apparently the new director general nicked his place in the bicycle rack at Broadcasting House.
Who is that all?
What worries me is this ultimate deterrent he's supposed to have.
Oh, that?
He showed it to me once.
It's pathetic. A pair of rusty iron anvils tied together with string.
Well, that wouldn't do anybody any harm.
You try picking it up, love.
I need men behind me. Men who don't know the meaning of the word trepidation.
Trepidation?
You'll do. Follow me and wave this copy of my little red book, The Thought of Kenneth Williams.
Thought?
He's only got the one.
Onwards, outwards, upwards, to a better tomorrow, where men are men and women are women.
Well, he's in there somewhere.
Listen.
Yes.
We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight in the streets. We few. Oh, we happy few. We...
Have you quite finished?
Yes. Oh, I did. I did enjoy that. Oh, I enjoyed it. Off my chest. Oh, I love that.
I'm glad. Glad somebody did.
Yeah.
Now, to give the show a little tone, which it so badly needs, we continue our tour of the ancestral home of the Earl of Shotterley.
Yes, welcome to Toll Purges Hall. The room I'm in today is reputed to be haunted by a fearful apparition known as the Whirling Monk. He's a whirler, you see. Yes, he appears on alternate Fridays and has a weird and ghastly habit. He comes out of the wardrobe, crosses the room and disappears through that wall where there used to be a door leading to the bathroom. Couple of minutes later, he returns and goes back in the wardrobe, as if some strange inner call has been answered. Of course, I've never seen him myself, but the last chambermaid reported mysterious knockings in the small hours and was forever rushing onto the landing crying, "Oh, I've seen it! I've seen it!" Silly. Yeah. Mind you, I'm very sceptical about these ghost stories.
I'm sorry to interrupt, my lord, but I've just seen a monk with his tonsure tucked underneath his arm. He disappeared through that wall.
Go, oh, absolute rubbish. Ghosts, indeed. I just had the place exorcised. Cost me a fortune. What wall did you say?
That one over there.
Oh, I don't believe you. Oh, well, the vicar will hear about this.
And now it's Crackerjack and Nori with Mother Time. When the music stops, Maud Nethersole will start telling one of her stories. And after that, it's every man for himself.
Hello, Tinies, and Huges too. What a helpful man the plumber is, isn't he? Anyway, mine is. Now, here's a story about someone who longed to become a plumber. A little girl called Florence.
Why, some buses are one of the plumbers in your bar,
she said. But, Florence, said her daddy, only little boys become plumbers, but you could become a plumber's mate. And Florence said... and Florence said... Which was very rude of her, wasn't it? And she went upstairs and wrote to Father Christmas asking for a blow lamp. But howsomever one day, all the taps in Florence's home stopped working. And after several weeks, Daddy said, we can't go on like this, Agnes. Better send for Mr. Potts the plumber and tell him to bring his plunger with him. Well, Mr. Potts examined all their pipes, and then he took a look under the kitchen sink. And what do you think he found? Florence. Hello, Florence, he said. What are you doing there?
Well, you must put them all in your mother's bed, Mama, they say.
So I see, said Mr. Potts. And it's very naughty of you to turn off the stopcock. Turn it on at once. And she did. And they were all drowned, except Florence, who lived happily ever after. Now, wasn't that a lovely story?
I don't know how she has the nerve.
And now, here's a song we can all dance to, and while I'm singing it, I shall be dancing too.
For mercy, we're not on television.
I'm a falling leaf, dancing in the breeze, and I sing a little song as well. Of a leaf who used to be very high upon a tree, but is really rather glad she fell. I'm an autumn breeze, dancing with a leaf underneath her family tree. The leaf grew on a bough, but she isn't on it now, and the one who blew her off was me. I'm a great big tree, swaying in the breeze. My branches are completely bare. Once I had a leaf, but that leaf has come to grief, and I can't say that I really care. 'Cause I've got a nest of robins in my hair.
Once again, we open the pages of my amazing pull-out supplement.
And on page one, our very own Correspondence Corner.
Oh, a heartless thief has stolen the saddle from my bicycle and I feel deeply wounded.
Yes, you would. Next.
I think I'm turning into a hermaphrodite. What can I do?
Several things spring to mind. Next.
People ignore me and pay no attention to what I say. Nobody ever listened to me. What can I do?
Next.
See, I told you.
I'm the mother of 19 children, and in these troubled times, my husband wonders if we're doing the right thing.
Can there be any doubt? Now we come to the feature we call Vardying Back, where famous personalities recall their early struggles. And today we hear about the life of a test pilot from two of those magnificent men in their flying machines.
Oh, hello, I'm Blue Max, and this is my friend and co-pilot, Sopwith Puck.
Oh, hello! Oh, yes, how very aeronautical to vardy a control tower through me flying goggles.
I see you're both wearing parachutes as well.
Mm.
Or are they bustles?
Only bones!
No, love, they're parachutes, all right. Oh, ran them up ourselves, we did.
Yes.
850 yards round the hem, they are.
Mm.
Every stitch done by hand.
At my hand.
Well, good.
And Ben, if you please, he won sequins on his.
Well, nothing elaborate, you know, just the odd cluster.
Yes, you and your odd cluster. Suppose some of them drop off when you're doing a jump.
Well,
you can get a very nasty bruise from a falling sequin.
Sounds terribly dangerous work.
Oh, he's still here, isn't he? Oh, here. Here, tell about how you got your pilot's license.
Oh, I don't think I should.
Go on, tell him.
No, the remembrance is too painful.
Oh, go on, tell him. Now purge yourself.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, I had this instructor, see.
Yeah, tell him his name. Tell him his name. It was Clint, wasn't it? Clint. Yeah, it was Clint.
Clint, yes.
Go on.
Well, Clint sort of took me under his wing.
Yeah. Took him under his wing, he got the chocks out.
Oh, I love the soft sentences.
You fooled the things in front of the wheels.
Oh, sorry.
Sentences. Things in front of the wheels.
Wheels,
go on.
I'm with you now.
Go on.
He asked me if I fancy a quick flip.
Yes, and you did.
Anyway, that one thing led to another, and Clint said, oh, I can't.
Go on. Tell him. Go on.
He said, I was ready to try the pilot's seat. But he said not to worry because he would be right behind me.
Right behind
me. Anyway, we're up to 1,000 feet and just cruising.
Yes.
Somewhere over the Isle of Man.
Nice.
Yes. That was nice. When suddenly we hit an air pocket and the plane goes into a dive, I turn to Clint for guidance and he's not there!
Clint's not there,
not
of course
there.
Not! He's still on the ground!
Yes.
Imagine it, Ducky, the plane plunging downwards towards the sea.
See?
The wind screaming up at him.
Screaming!
Him screaming back. He tries to bail out, but his ripcord's all knotted round the joystick.
Yes.
Then tell him.
I hear Clint's voice coming up from ground control.
Use the ejector seat, he shouts. Use the ejector seat, it's your only hope. But did he use it? Did he?
No, I didn't.
Why ever not?
Tell him why you didn't use the ejector seat.
Well, I hate being sent up.
Once again, it's time for yet another return visit from our wandering pop group, those two hits and a misses, Peter, Paul and Mrs. Nosepoltice. Are you about to amaze us with another infectious ditty culled from the substrata of some primitive community?
Oh, certainly not. We're going to sing.
I was afraid you might.
It's a track from our latest folk album, which has just come into the charts at number 3.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, in Formosa. We've stayed around and played around Camden Town too long.
Summer's been and gone,
and winter's coming on.
We've stayed around and played around Camden Town too long.
It's time we all moved on.
We'll hit the trail to Maidenvale, or maybe Gold is Green.
I've heard from folks who've been, the beds are very clean.
They've got a lovely cemetery, the best you've ever seen.
It's time we all moved on.
A lady who my brother knew had been to Finchley West.
And she was most impressed.
Oh, Finchley West is best. 'Cause there you'll find they drop the blind before they get undressed.
It's time we all move on.
They say it's good in Cricklewood and nice in Easton too.
The buses run right through, you're on the Bakerloo.
And can the things we've heard about Cock Fosters will be true?
It's time we all move on.
But it is
time, it's time we all move on.
Again, we come to our film adaptation. This week, a science fiction film with a difference. In association with Stanley Halfbrick, we proudly present... ...2002, A Space Oddity. The Dawn of Man. A small group of hairy, brutish figures... ...are huddling in a gully. As we move closer to see what they're doing, we ask ourselves, can these be men? And as we move closer still, we conclude that some of them must be. We sent our roving reporter to interview them.
Hello, I'm standing by these ape creatures with a microphone in my hand.
Ain't that an anachronism?
No, it's a microphone. Now, can you tell me something about yourself?
Well, we are your actual first generation, and we're busy learning how to make things.
But such as what?
A second generation.
Yeah, it was trial and error, but I think we finally hit on how it's done.
Yeah?
We rubbed two sticks together.
Genius!
Oh, yeah, that's nothing, though. You should see the way we try to make fire.
But mankind is not to stay at this level. Oh, neither is the humor, I hope. The turning point is the sudden appearance of something huge and alien.
Oh, look, a black monolithic slab.
Touch it and see what happens.
Hang on, let's have a look at the slab first.
As he reached out and touched the slab, something strange, mysterious, and rather wonderful happened. It fell on him. His mind began to work.
Here, I just thought of an invention. Look, a round, flat thing to go on the corner of carts with spokes and a steel rim.
What are you going to call it?
Fire. Let's have a glass of wine to celebrate. What have we got?
Well, there's a bottle of bone, year one.
Is that a good year?
No, but it's the only one we got. Cheers.
They drained their glasses and flung the bottle of bone high in the air. It cartwheeled lazily and... 4 million years later. Oh, the magic of radio. It became a rocket ship approaching an orbiting space station.
The rocket now approaching space platform 4 is the 222 from Venus. Passengers for the moon and Finchley Central change approved.
Miss, my name is Dr. Rapacious Dose Frittering. I want you to fly me to the moon.
Oh, yes.
And let me play among the stars. Let me know what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, second class return, please. Thank you for helping.
Welcome to the moon, Dr. Luce Fritting. Thank goodness you've come. We've discovered another black monolithic slab.
Woo!
It seems to be sending out some sort of alien message.
To whom?
Granny and the twins and all at number 10 Sebastopol Terrace, Jupiter.
Jupiter?
A multi-million pound expedition was launched towards Jupiter. Aboard the mighty spaceship were two astronauts. First, Gramercy Muckwicket.
That's me. My spacesuit has a life support system based on constantly recirculating moisture.
The second astronaut was the superbly trained Cyril Tuft.
Yes, I can do things in free fall that make your eyes pop out. You can rely on me to hold up my end.
Yes. There was one snag having Cyril on the mission. You see, he liked to sleep with the windows open. Silly, really, because outside was a complete vacuum of space.
I, Douglas Smith, play the complete vacuum. I have an extendable nozzle for getting into awkward corners, and I suck up filth wherever I go. You can get me going by plugging me in at any point. Why not try me on your carpet?
I should be so desperate.
Suck, suck.
Also, aboard ship was a fantastic computer called Sal.
Hello, boys. Yes, I have been made so that I can talk. Though you'd never guess it from the last two pages. I'm in charge of the ship, and I'm completely infallible. Allible. Allible. Allible.
Oh, give her a bang.
Mary had a little lamb, the midwife had a fit. Exterminate all Earth creatures. Thanks for the memory. They say a computer is neuter. It suits as a mute sort of tutor. I refute with a hoot, you're a dissolute mute, and en route for a boot up the hooter.
Yes, I think we may have trouble, huh? Gramercy. Where's Gramercy Muckwicket? What have you done with him, you tin witch?
I've sent him to play outside. Evil chuckle as of computer gone round the twist.
Outside without his wellies?
Oh, you know what's out there.
Suck, oh. Suck.
Sad to say, I was finished, a dried up husk, spinning slowly towards the sun. But the mighty spaceship sped onwards to its destination.
You've killed him, you cybernetic coquette. Very well, you leave me no choice. I shall strip down your working parts.
Oh, no, not that!
Yes, I wipe your spools, so...
Get down, I'm ticklish.
Then I pull out your sensitized flip flop, so. Then I cut off your input output selectors. And twist your digital diodes. There.
Oh, dear, you are.
Yeah, now you do it to me.
It's another black monolithic slab.
Let's see. Intergalactic Cornflakes Company. Black monolithic slab number 3. Collect the full set and win a fortnight's holiday in Venus.
On the other side, it's the Stop Messing About Orchestra and Chorus popping up yet again at the crucial moment for the cheery song to get us out.
2001, when man begun, when he developed space drive. 4 million years to the closing credits, but it felt more like 5.
So ends this week's film adaptation. All that remains is a comment from Mr. Paddock.
I never file my fingernails. Just throw them away.
And a word from Kenneth Williams to the man who waved at him from the pink Rolls Royce.
I've got your number, Duffy. There you go.
That was Stop Messing About with Kenneth Williams, Hugh Paddock, Joan Sims and the Max Harris Group. The script was by Johnny Mortimer and Brian Cook and Miles Rudge. The producer was John Simmons.
You ain't heard nothing yet.
And so we've been out interviewing people from all sorts of walks of life. Good morning, sir.
Hello, Honky Tonk, how are you?
I see you're a Cortina owner.
That's right, Honky Tonk, yes.
How do you find it?
Sauce box.
No, I was referring to the Carter.
Oh, I see. Yes, well, it is nice. It's a lovely shape. It's very she-she. And a beautiful colour.
Could you think of any way we could improve it?
Well, you could have made the glove compartment a bit bigger.
Oh, you need a larger one.
Oh, cheeky.
No, the glove box.
No, well, I've just bought this new handbag, you see, and I can't pop it in anymore.
Oh, I see. Yeah, I can believe that. What about all the knobs and the buttons?
Well, I don't think they're such an attractive feature as some I could mention. I mean, they could be more shapely.
Oh, yes, yes. Oh, well, thank you, sir. I hope I haven't bothered you.
Oh, you haven't bothered me, love. Nice to see you. Bye.
Excuse me, miss.
Oh, hello.
Is this your car?
It's my boyfriend's, really.
Well, I bet you've had some experience with
it. Oh, an awful lot. There's a lot of room in the back.
Does he have any complaints, or is he satisfied?
He should be.
No, what I mean was, is he satisfied with the ride?
Well, he does sometimes say it's a bit hard.
Yes, but when you're going along the road, do you find it relaxing and comfortable?
Well, isn't that rather dangerous? I will say this. The springs could be better.
Yes. You like a nice, soft ride.
Pardon?
You like a nice, soft ride.
Oh, you are awful. But I like you.
Would you like to answer one or two questions about this car?
Only too happy to oblige, my son. Are you coming to Evensong?
I'm afraid I'm rather busy at the moment. Are there any features about this Cortina in general you'd like to comment on?
Oh, they're very good value, you know. The Bishop car has a good pedigree.
I see. What about space?
Oh, space in abundance, yes. Why, the Bishop has had a number of choir boys in the back and room to spare.
Oh, it has surplus space.
Oh, no. We keep those at the vestry. We need those for Evensong. Are you coming to Evensong?
I'm afraid I am rather busy. From what you say, the bishop gets almost the whole choir in the car. What about him?
Oh, we don't attempt any singing in the car. It tends to steam the windows up.
What about the fascia trim?
Oh, well, I don't like all this imitation plastic and woodwork, you know. I prefer the good old English oak.
What about the performance?
Oh, the bishop's very pleased with it, you know. 410 he's had out of it.
You obviously know a lot about Cortinas. Which model is yours?
Oh, I don't own one myself, my son. But if the collection keeps coming through, see what evens on.
Excuse me, madam.
Miss.
Sorry, miss.
Do you like my car? I've just been through the car wash. It's a beauty, isn't it? Would you like to try it?
No, thank you. I'd like to ask you a few questions. Are you willing?
Oh, yes, I am.
What I meant was, what first attracted you to buying the Cortina?
Well, I like big windows all round.
Oh, you like all-round visibility?
Yes, you see, and then I won't miss any men who are trying to attract my attention.
Oh, yes. Is any dislikes about the car?
Yes, well, I find the dials are a bit confusing, because, you see, I can't keep my eyes on the dials and on the pavement at the same time.
You mean the road?
Well, most men walk on the pavement. I nearly had a terrible accident last week.
Oh, yes, what caused that?
The axle noise.
The axle noise caused an accident?
When you see a man across the street tried to attract my attention and I nearly didn't hear him.
Oh, I see. Tell me, do you like good handling?
Oh, yes, I do. Are you married? Oh, I'm looking for a nice young man like you.
Excuse me, sir. That's a very nice car. You must spend a lot of time on it.
Yeah, well, I would have been quicker under the lock on this car. It's a very good one. Hey, who are you then?
Well, I'm interviewing Cortina owners, and yes? I wonder if you'd answer a few questions about this car.
Like what?
Well, how do you find the performance?
Ah, super for a fast getaway. Yeah. I beat a police car in one like this morning. Just like this one.
Just like this one?
Yeah, that's right.
Any other features?
Oh, yeah. They're good on a second-hand car market.
Oh, yes, so I believe it. Yeah. Are you thinking of selling it, then?
Oh, yeah, I'm going to do that, okay.
Why? Are you unhappy with it? I mean, could it be the ventilation?
Well,
Let's say it's up.
Oh, I see. And you're happy with the performance, are you?
Yeah. Well, a 1600 engine could do better. I nearly done a police car. Tweet was parked right across the high street.
Parked across the high street? That's very stupid of them, wasn't
it? Yeah. If I'd have been 5 seconds earlier, he wouldn't have had time to set up a roadblock.
Hey! That's my car!
Two comedy classic songs coming up next. First, Jasper Carrot, with A Day Trip to Blackpool, and Charlie Drake, with I Bent My Ass a Guy.
Didn't we have a miserable time the day we went to Blackpool? An horrible day, we got drunk on the way and spent our money on chips and bingo. Hour after hour, we spent in a bar and we drank a barrel of cider. And on the way back, I was sick over Jack and the rain came down. Oh, do you recollect the abbot we wrecked as we vandalised the seafront? Sydney the punk, he lost a chunk from his head when he nutted a parking meter. I'll never forget all the fish that we ate as we staggered round the fairground. We distributed ales from the big Ferris wheel and the rain came down. Eric and Sid, they bet us a quid they could climb the Blackpool Tower. Newcastle Brown made Eric fall down, we carried him into a Wimpy bar. Sidney threw up right into his cup and we had to call the waiter. Then Eric was ill right all over his bill and the rain came down. Oh, Eric and me, we wanted a pee, so we climbed up on the bandstand. We recycled booze all over our shoes and quite a lot over the band as well. We jumped into our car, but we didn't get far, 'cause a policeman waved us down. We must have been out of our brain, 'cause we came down by train. The rain came down and the rain.
In the jungle, a warrior stood there 5'3", surrounded by a tribe of Zulus dancing round the belly gum tree.
Violence in court! Zulu Drake, you were charged with cowardice in the face of a king of Jew. Have you anything to say before we pass sentence?
I bent my ass a guy.
You bent your ass a guy.
I bent my ass a guy. See the jelly roll to the sky.
Speak, you sinner. Speak, you sinner.
Well, stood alone in the mood for war. Suddenly alarmed with the mighty roar. Took a flying leap as he got near. I tried to lift my 6 foot spear. With a yell, I tripped and fell. Bent my ass a guy.
Hummer, hummer, knocker, knocker, upper, hoo, ha. Hummer, hummer, knocker, knocker, upper, hoo, ha.
Silence! It is the sentence of this court that you be banished to Pygmy Land.
Aha! Oh no, not that. They're all bigger than me. I shall very likely get Pygmalioned.
A warrior stood alone and shaken, head bent low and a tear in his eye. Left his right with his heart all broken, banished to the Pygmy Sky.
Good gracious, pygmies. Hello, pygmies. I've been banished. Am I in time for tea?
Silence! Why have you been banished here, Zulu boy?
I bent my ass a guy.
You bent your ass a guy.
I bent my ass a guy. See the I tried to lift my 6 foot spear, and with a yell, I tripped and fell. Bent my ass a guy.
You're welcome to stay here, Zulu boy. You can have the bed hut on the left.
Oh, gracias, as we Zulus say.
Looks a nice hat.
I wonder if anybody's home. I'll ring the bell.
Hello, Zulu boy.
Oh, who are you?
I'm Pygmalion Lou. Come in and have some Skokian.
Skokian?
The Zulu boy and the pygmy amazing, married, and as years went by, lots of little pygmy and Zulus lived together in the pygmy
Writer, poet, and broadcaster Pam Ayres has been making her fans smile for more than 30 years, since her first television appearance on Opportunity Knocks. Now some of her best sketches, verses and songs are brought together in her Radio 4 show, Ayres on the Air. Pam performs witty and wonderful pieces on subjects as diverse as getting older, shopping and a surfeitive beige, bored chickens and school plays. With each sketch, she delights and entertains in a way that is unique to this very special broadcaster.
Any plans for Valentine's, Pam?
Wait till I tell you. We're having a passionate weekend in Canada. Gordon's going to show me Viagra.
You mean Niagara?
It's my weekend. I'll enjoy it however I want.
On the Air with Pam Ayres, Felicity Montague and Jeffrey Whitehead.
Hello and a very warm welcome to Ayres on the Air. It's lovely to see so many people here, and the topic of today's programme is passion. Not, I hasten to add, that I know much about it. I don't. I was brought up in a fairly repressed sort of time, really. And if anybody in our family started talking about sex, someone would always smartly shut them up and say, we were not having any more of that muck. Thank you very much. No, so there was no discussion of any sort, really. It was pathetic because I tried to learn things by looking them up in the dictionary, but I could never pronounce the words. When you talk about passion, you're not necessarily talking about sex, are you? I mean, you can be passionate about all manner of things. You can be passionate about sport, films, books, all that kind of thing. I used to work with a man who was very passionate, and this is true, about making models out of matchsticks. And he made the most fantastic creations. He made several cathedrals and a grand piano. I don't know what happened to him. I think something catastrophic happened, actually. I think his wife lit a fag and the whole thing went up in flames. But I think when most people consider the word passion, they think about the bedroom, don't they, really? And as it happens, I've just bought a bed because our eldest son, he's got a place of his own now and he's been furnishing it. And it came up to his birthday and we thought that a nice present for a vigorous young man would be a good double bed and a mattress. So that's what we got him. And also a lady at work was selling some sofas that she didn't need anymore. So she sold them to him at a bargain price. So he was pleased about that. And so he had all this stuff, the sofas and the bed and the mattress all piled up, and they got a trailer and he got his dad to come and help him, and they went off to install it all into his new home. And within about 3/4 of an hour, they were back with faces like thunder, because it's a very small place where he lives. And unfortunately, he had not been able to get the sofas through the front door, and neither had they been able to get the mattress up the stairs. See, and they came back and they were fuming because they'd had all this heaving stuff around and it was hot. But I could see the funny side of it. And I had to go off to another part of the house and have a good laugh because I could see the funny side of it. And interestingly, whenever I spoke to my friends about this getting the mattress up the stairs, business, it seemed that everybody had a story on the subject. You know, everybody said to me, well, wait till I tell you what happened to us when we tried to get the mattress up the stairs. And people said they'd had to take the window frames out and they'd had to take the banisters off, and somebody had actually made a hole in the wall. And so as we're talking about passion, and this involves a great deal of pushing and thrusting, I thought it might be highly appropriate. So I don't like to be left out, and this is my story on the subject. We had our bedroom painted. It was rather tired and dated, and the curtains had grown shabby where the wasps had hibernated. There were cracks across the ceiling if you gazed around on high, and I loved the carpet once, although I can't imagine why. But when we had decorated, as it often is the case, the other items in the room looked dingy, out of place. The mattress in particular had seen a better day. A picture of exhaustion. It was shattered. It was grey. If I'd had a microscope on looking through the lens, I knew I'd just see undesirables, dust mites and allergens. And so, as ours was old and with regard to all these points, we went to buy a new one to relieve our aching joints. While the mattress man droned on about the way that they were made, the pockets and the springing and the buttons and the braid, he had beds made of leather, he had beds made of wood, on and on he went. We thought we'd drop off where we stood. He said it was imperative that the spine is lying straight, unlike on our old bed where we scribe a figure eight. And so we bought a new one, taking note of all his tips and looked forward to support at ankle, shoulders, knees and hips. We looked fondly at the mattress as it came in from the street. Well, it was something for ourselves, a luxury, a little treat. We looked forward to the time when we'd be locking up the door, taking our glucosamine and giving it what for. On the day it was delivered, I was happy as a queen. It was wrapped magnificently, swathed in polythene. We carried out the old one and we lent it on the gate, intending to fly-tip it at a later, darker date. We hurried back indoors and we were gaily unawares that the new one had a problem. It would not go up the stairs. No, it would not go up the stairs. It was too rigid, wide and strong. We angled it and dangled it, but no, we'd got it wrong. My man took up the challenge with defiance on his face. He stripped away the banisters encroaching on the space. The door came off its hinges. The frame came off and split. He sweated and he fretted and it didn't help a bit. We tried it soft and gentle. We tried it mean and rough. We got it up a little way, but nothing like enough. He was heaving with his shoulder. I was pulling from above, but the mattress wasn't shifting, not for money, not for love. Well, I kicked it in the pockets and I kicked it in the springs. I kicked it in the label and the little button things. Well, you could tell that it despised us as it flopped this way and that. It said, I hope you break your ankle. Kick away, you daft old bat. Then laugh. We had convulsions. We were helpless. We couldn't stop. We laughed until the moment that he felt his back go pop. Now he is moaning. He is groaning. It's a grim state of affairs. And he'll have to suffer standing because we can't get up the stairs.
Now, can I have your attention, please, everyone? Once again, a very warm welcome to Speedy Flirt, the fun speed dating evening where you might just meet that special person. Remember, when you hear the klaxon, you must move on to the next person at the next table because this means that your 3 minutes is up. Off you go, then, and remember our motto, it's assert with Speedy Flirt.
Oh, hello. You're table one, Lucy. I'll come and talk to you, if that's all right.
Yes, it's fine. Let me see your badge. Stuart, I've never done speed dating before.
Well, no, neither have I. Still, it's a great way to meet people, isn't it? I never meet anybody in my job.
Oh, I know we're not supposed to ask, but what's your job, Stuart?
I'm a farrier.
Oh, I love horses.
Do you? Well, I work all round the racing stables. The trouble is, people just give me the horse and leave me to it. And they aren't much good at conversation.
No, I don't suppose horses are.
Well, what do you do, Lucy?
Me? Oh, I'm a nanny. Oh. I love children, and I might as well come clean and say that I would love to have a family of my own.
Oh, that's just what I want, Lucy. Oh. The happy sound of children's laughter in the harmonious home.
And they could have a pony each.
Oh, darn, I have to move to the next table, but you certainly get a tick on my card, Lucy.
And you on mine.
Right. Table number two. Hello, there you are. My name's Stuart.
You're a bit over the hill for this lark, aren't you? Have you got your own teeth?
Pardon?
Come on, sit down. Any debt? Are you solvent?
Am I what?
Got your own hair, own house. Where do you work?
I'm a farrier. I work with horses.
Oh, I can't stand horses. Those great big yellow teeth. Still, one compensation, we'd be all right for dung.
Indeed.
Got any kids?
None at all.
Don't worry, I've got seven, all by different dads. I believe in diversifying the gene pool.
Really?
Any lunacy on your side at all? I mean, you can't be too careful. Someone who looks perfectly normal can turn out to be a loud-mouthed freak.
You don't say.
What religion are you, then? You won't be getting any ticks from me if you're one of these weird sects. Ha-ha! Listen to me! Weird sects! Still, it takes all sorts.
This is the longest 3 minutes of my life.
Come on now, you haven't asked me anything yet. Go on, ask away.
Oh, well, what would you say was the most interesting thing about you?
Me? Well, nothing really, but my first husband was famous round here because he ran the 4-minute mile.
I'm just about to do the same.
If you do find your perfect partner, whether by speed dating or any other means, the next thing that you might start thinking about is the wedding. And I went to a lovely wedding in the spring of this year in Kent. And it was a most beautiful little Norman church. And there was all this blossom in the churchyard. There was pink and white, a great abundance of blossom in this darling little Norman church. And do you know, the bride wore her grandmother's dress. Her grandmother was freezing, but she looked very, very nice. And interestingly, the wedding was at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I always prefer a morning wedding myself, because if the marriage doesn't work out, you haven't wasted the whole day. Well, that's exhausted my stock of joke book jokes on the subject of marriages. But to be serious, I have to say that of late, I don't enjoy weddings as much as I used to. I used to love them. I used to really look forward to them, and you'd plan what you're going to wear and all that. But now, I don't know, it's changed, and I find myself looking at my watch. And I know that makes me sound a bit of a misery, but in this poem, I try and give you some idea of why I feel as I do. This is called Don't Ask Me to the Wedding. So, your daughter's getting married, and your fine athletic son. Well, send my love and warm congratulations to them, everyone. I wish them health and happiness and joyful expectation, but don't ask me to the wedding. Do not send the invitation. It's not that I don't care or I'm too mean to send a gift. I just know that at the wedding, every grievance, every rift, every bitter family feud that simmered slowly down the years will come boiling to the surface after one too many beers. I do not have to be there. I can still describe the day. The best man, he'll be nervous. The vicar, he'll be gay. The ushers will be pimply, the babies will all shriek, and ex-wives and ex-husbands look with loathing and don't speak. Ah, the fragrance of the flowers, the stained glass like a jewel, the murmur of the organ, the bridesmaids minuscule, the shyness of the couple, their tenderness and tears. You'd never guess they'd live together now for 7 years. You know, I loved the marriage service, knowing this old church had heard the same vows down the centuries, repeated word for word. But that's all out of fashion, just another thing to scrub. They made this up themselves on Friday evening down the pub. No Lord's Prayer, no familiar words, no blessing. It was odd. We gathered there in someone's sight, but I don't think it was God. But the church was bathed in sunshine, the steeple bells were pealing, the dress, it was expensive, and the neckline was revealing. In the shop, I loved my saucy feathered hat, I did. The sales girl said, delightful, and I paid 200 quid. But looking in the mirror as I locked the house to leave, I looked just like a turkey left behind on Christmas Eve. My shoes are proving painful. They have made my toes go numb and are holding out the promise of much greater things to come. Of course, they're things of beauty, stylish, fashionable and sleek. But as I walk through the churchyard, I can hear me bunions creak. Ah, here comes a photographer. We're lined up like the royals, standing here so long he could have painted us in oils. While everybody's restless now, we're ready for the off and snouts are getting anxious for a rummage in the trough. The couple cut the cake and on the knife each placed a hand. The best man made a speech, but he was drunk and couldn't stand. We clapped for all the speakers and our duty did not shirk. Although we couldn't hear the microphone, it didn't work. We're ready for the sausage rolls, we're ready for the ale. We're ready for the feast, no point in letting it get stale. I'm piling up me plate and then I'm going back for more to fortify myself before I get out on that floor. Three things to fill your heart with dread and make your innards shrivel. A marquee and a disco and a DJ spouting drivel. He's cranking up the volume, turning up the flashing lights, and there's women dancing barefoot with their feet stuck through their tights. Old bones and hip replacements. They are grinding off the dust. Grandpa's doing a kind of geriatric pelvic thrust. The shake, the okey cokey, the conga and the twist, and the whole pulsating bunch are getting absolutely intoxicated. Gyrating, undulating, it is sweaty and it's hot. Separate and desperate, we're dancing on the spot. An elbow in the back, a sharp stiletto in the shin, and there's lechery, treachery, darkly in the din. It's not polite to leave before the couple, it is said, and yet a vision rises of a warm and comfy bed, a nice electric blanket and a pillow soft and deep. The party rages on. I wish I was at home asleep. So don't ask me to the wedding. I insist it's for the best. Send my invitation to some bright and youthful guest. And for now, let's toast the couple. Tell them tales of my remorse. And in a couple of years, I'll come and drink to the divorce. Here you go, Gordon. If I came home upset because my boss had been horrid to me, would you, A...
Stop, Pam, stop right there. This is one of those stupid multi-choice questionnaires from What Woman magazine or whatever you call it. I'm not being dragged into picking one of their answers. They're all stupid anyway.
Are they just okay? Well, I won't give the options then. Just tell me what you do.
What? You mean make it up myself?
Yes, Gordon, it can't be that hard. I'm your wife and I'm emotional. What do you do?
Well, I'd get you to make a list of the problems and then systematically go through them in a reasoned manner. I think you'd soon see you were overreacting.
No, Gordon, the correct answer is to give me a cuddle.
Well, that's all well and good, but I don't see how it's really addressing the root of the problem.
No, you don't, do you? All right, try this. I'm in tears because I've overheard a friend of mine telling somebody that my new haircut makes me look like Russell Brand.
Yeah, I remember that haircut. You did look quite like...
Gordon, that is not helping.
No, sorry. Well, I'd look at the haircut, and if you really did look like Russell Brand, I'd take you straight back to the barber's, and have it out with them, see if I couldn't force them to recut it at no charge.
The answer was give me a cuddle. You don't have to try to sort everything out, Gordon. Just show me you love me.
Really?
OK, you come home from the office to find me tearful and covered head to foot in flour because the meal I'm cooking for your boss and his wife, who's due to arrive in 30 minutes, is going disastrously wrong.
Ah, yes. I'd give you a cuddle.
Oh, don't be absurd, Gordon. Didn't you hear me say your boss and his wife are due in 30 minutes? All you do is end up with flour all over your suit and give me even more work to do. Sometimes, Gordon, you really don't think, do you?
I try not to.
If your love life becomes a bit stale, one of the things you can do to try and invigorate the whole relationship is to take up an activity that you can enjoy together, a sport, for instance, or dancing.
OK, everybody in a circle with their partners. Tonight we learn the tango, the dance of le oeuvre.
Oh, blimey, Pam, you know I'm not designed to dance. I really don't know why you talked me into this.
Because I thought we needed to get a little spice back into our lives.
But we tried dancing together just last week.
That was the okey-cokey at Brian's retirement, dude. It's hardly the heights of passion.
Oh, I don't know, I really like the way you shook it all about.
Well, it's time for you to start shaking yours about tango, the dance of love. Come on, let's see if your hips still move.
OK, gentlemen, your partner is a beautiful rose. Take her in your arms and gently pull her towards you.
Right. Come here, then.
Oi, she said rose. You're heaving me round like a sack of taters.
Now gaze into her eyes. The man must dominate the woman. Seduce her.
Oh, come on, Gordon, seduce me. Gordon, you're supposed to be gazing into me eyes.
I can't when we're pressed this close. I can't focus.
Ladies, twist your hips around to the right. Remember, we want sharp, clean movements in the tango. Step back on the left foot and raise your right knee.
Ooh.
And don't be afraid to engage with your sexuality.
Ooh, ooh, you've certainly engaged with mine, Pam. You were supposed to raise your right knee.
Oh, I'm sorry, I got me left and right mixed up.
So have I now.
Gentlemen, hold your woman. Ladies, lean back in his arms. Right back, ladies. Lean back as far as you can go.
Well, go on, Pam.
Any further and it'll be permanent.
Don't be silly. Let me help you.
Oh. Oh! Oh, Gordon, something snapped.
Is it your back?
No, it's me wonder bra.
Well, don't wriggle. I'm supporting all your weight.
What do you mean, all me weight?
Not as light as you used to be, that's all.
Oh, blimey, the okey-cokey was more passionate than this.
Now sway your partner and pull her to you. Yes, make it hot, make it steamy. The raw sexuality that is tango.
She's getting on my nerves too. It's all well and good for an Argentinian stick insect. Next time I hear someone say lean back, they better be talking about bacon.
Crispy bacon.
And crusty white bread. Do you know, I haven't had a bacon butty for ages.
Tomato sauce.
Proper butter.
Mm. There's a cafe round the corner, you know. Shall we?
You mean leave the dance class and go and stuff ourselves with bacon butties?
It would be naughty.
But nice. See, I knew we weren't too old to get passionate about something. Grab your coat. One performer that I have always felt passionate about is Bruce Springsteen. I've always loved Bruce Springsteen. A long time ago in the 80s, I wrote what was a bit like Frank Sinatra and my way, really. I wrote a poem which people always asked me to do for a long time. It was one of my greatest hits, and it was called Do You Think Bruce Springsteen Would Fancy Me? And I'll just give you a little fragment of it. It went like this. Do you think Bruce Springsteen would fancy me? I know I've just turned 63 and one eye's gone at a funny angle. And I have to wear a copper bangle because I've got arthritis in this right knee. But do you think Bruce Springsteen would fancy me? Of course, Bruce is used to admiration. He is idolised in every nation. He's cheered and clapped in every state. Me, I'm clapped at 8:30. Mind you, his music does an half blast away the cobwebs.
Springsteen. Puh.
Shush, Gordon.
Well, Bruce Springsteen, are you going to watch that flaming DVD all night?
No, Gordon, I'm not. We're going to bed. Now.
Really?
Yes, that's it, Gordon. Get your badass butt on the bed.
Pam, you seem different tonight.
I know. I've decided we're going to try something new.
Oh, my God. Handcuffs.
Yes, Gordon. Put your hand there.
Oh, Pam.
Put your other hand there. And now you're utterly helpless. A slave manacled to the DFS bedpost.
Oh, my God. This is amazing. What now?
I put this gag in your mouth. And now that you're unable to move a muscle or utter a syllable, I'm going to have the most erotic experience a mature married woman can hope for in Gloucestershire. Yes, Gordon. Now that I don't have to worry about your constant whittering in my ear, I'm going downstairs to watch the rest of me Bruce Springsteen. I used to think that longing for passionate involvement was just something felt by young people, but I don't believe that at all now. I don't know about men, but I don't think that women ever lose it. I think most of us go through life, despite all the knocks, still waiting, still believing that the one who's going to make everything all right will still appear. I still haven't given up hope, you know. I still await the day when my true romantic hero comes to carry me away. I've been married 30 years, some people think that long. But my husband's just a stopgap till the real one comes along. Yes, like Lawrence of Arabia across the burning sand, I see him ride towards me and I take his outstretched hand. I see his pearly teeth, the flash of sunlight on enamel. And if love cannot sustain us, we shall have to eat the camel. I'm off up then.
Good night.
Why don't you come up with me?
I will, after news night.
I'll be asleep by then.
I won't disturb you.
I want to be disturbed. Gordon.
I heard you.
Let's bring back some spontaneous passion into our marriage.
But it's Wednesday.
So?
Well, can't we wait till the weekend break in Bridport?
Oh, if we did, it wouldn't be passion, it'd be an appointment.
Exactly. And anticipation is an aphrodisiac.
So are you saying that by the time we get to Bridport, you'll be so aflame with desire that you'll kick open the bedroom door and ravish me on the carpet?
Well, I'm not promising, but I'll certainly be prepared.
Well, you make it sound like Bob a Job Week. When was the last time you really wanted me, called out my name, flung away your clothes?
Monday afternoon.
You mean when you took off your cardigan and demanded that I sew on the button? Well, that doesn't count.
You're right. You're a beautiful, desirable woman, and I want you. I want you now. Get up those stairs.
Crikey. Right, I will.
And I'll be right behind you.
Hurry up.
Once I've put the cat out, bolted the door, left a note for the milkman and switched out the lights.
And checked your emails?
Glad you reminded me. Airs on the Air starred Pam Ayres, Felicity Montague and Geoffrey Whitehead. It was written by Pam Ayres, Christopher Thompson, Peter Reynolds and Jan Etherington. The producer was Claire Jones.
Friendspin now!
Here's another giggle for you. First it's Ivor Biggins sings Toolbag Ted from Birkenhead. Then followed by Benny Hill and Gather in the Mushrooms.
I always have been handy. I did a bit of do it myself until it knackered my eyesight and compromised my health. Then a geezer popped his napper over the garden wall. Good day, he said. My name is Ted. Can I be of any help at all? Well, I should have said no tar, no thanks, no props. But instead, I told him all my little jobs. And now he's round my house as soon as I walk out my door, ripping my missus' drawers out and banging on the bedroom floor. He's Toolbag Ted from Birkenhead, the randy handyman. He walks in when I walk out and does a bloody sight better than ever I can. When a lady says,
I'm desperate, and only your spanner will do.
Oh, Teddy seems to understand. He bolts round at their command with his nuts held tightly in his hand. Look, look, hammer, hammer, bang through.
Oh, Ted, stop this.
You don't suppose he's messing my old woman around, do you?
Oh, Ted, you're terrible.
Where does he get the energy? How can he manage it all? He flashes all around the chimney. He hammers up and down the hall. If a lady's got a problem that's been troubling her all day, an expert prod with his dino rod and the problem goes away. Mrs. Brown, she called him on the phone.
Oh, please come round. My husband's not at home.
He rearranged her portico and banged her beam all day, stripping her chimney breast out and sticking in his RSJ. He's Toolbag Ted from Birkenhead, the randy handyman. No job too busy reeling. He might be messing my old woman around. This merry Merseysider is always making house calls. The ladies ring his number and this randy handy scouse calls. Some husbands do not like it when he does what he does best, but most let him get on with it. They're grateful for the rest. And aren't you glad when an expert comes to call and sorts out your old boiler and doesn't charge at all? And in her darkest corners he will make a final stand, halfway up her skirting with his stopcock in his hand. Toolbag Ted from Birkenhead, the randy handyman. A knight in shining overalls, he'll be there whenever he can. He never leaves the job half done and he always sees it through. A set of drawers might need a number. What's it needs a thing of evolved. In fact, he's always on the job. Rub, rub, hammer, hammer, bang through.
Ted.
You know,
ooh,
he's messing my old woman around.
Ted.
The dirty sex mass bastard.
Ooh,
I'll have him. I'll tear him limb from limb.
Ooh,
I'll bend his pipe. I'll wipe his joint. I'll give him a black and decker work, mate. You dirty bastard.
Go on, then. In there, in there.
Yeah, all right, all right. And now, ladies and gentlemen,
they know what they are.
We have a treat in store for you.
And indeed,
for all of us.
Too.
As well.
Well, yeah. Here to give us a solo.
Is
our worthy.
And respected. Choir Master Ted Grumble.
Well, that's a surprise, I must say. However, since I have been called upon, I shall give you a new song. It's in the Modern Idiot, and it goes something like this.
Now Lucy went down on a farm, tried to milk a cow. Though she tried, she couldn't get the hang of it somehow. The farmer looked at Lucy, and he murmured with a frown, "Well, now you just hang on tightly, gal, and she'll jump up and down."
Oh, gather in the mushrooms, put them in a pot, pop them in the oven, and serve them piping hot.
To make herself more beautiful, she thought she'd bathe in milk. She said, "I'll have a bath." Well, to her milkman, Jackie Wilk, he said, "You want it pasteurized before I pour it in?" She said, "No, I'll be happy if it comes up to me chin."
Oh, gather in the mushrooms, put them in a pot, pop them in the oven, and serve them piping hot.
The farmer caught it, Lucy, one dark and stormy night. She said, "You are too old for me because your hair is white." He looked into her eyes and then he knew he'd have to tell her, "There's snow upon the roof, but there's a fire in the cellar."
Oh, gather in the mushrooms, put them in a pot, pop them in the oven, the servant piping hot.
She took him in the kitchen, she was his turtle dove, and then she started cooking dumplings on the stove. She wore a low-cut dress, ooh, it was as green as clover. He jumped with glee, cause he could see her dumplings boiling over.
Oh, gather in the mushrooms, put them in a pot,
pop them in the oven and serve them piping hot.
She said, you give me half a crown and I will read your palm. And then she saw his love line went halfway up his arm. So now she's changed her prices, although she's just as willing. It's big fat men at £2.10 and little boys a shilling.
Oh, gather in the mushrooms, put them in a pot. Pop them in the oven and serve them piping hot. We're gonna gather in the mushrooms, put them in a pot. Pop them in the oven and serve them piping hot.
Parsley Sidings is a BBC radio sitcom of the early 1970s, created by Jim Eldridge. It stars Arthur Lowe and Ian Lavender, and Kenneth Connor. The show is set in a sleepy, out-of-the-way railway station, on the main line between London and Birmingham, in the Midlands. The main characters are the station master, Mr. Horace Hepplewhite, played by Arthur Lowe, his son, Bertrand, Ian Lavender, station porter Percy Valentine, Kenneth Connor, Mr. Bradshaw, the signalman, also played by Kenneth Connor, as was Clara the station hen, and station tannoy announcer Gloria Simpkins. Liz Fraser, the guest cast in some episodes included Bill Pertwee, Roger Delgado. The announcer for the program being Keith Skews.
Being on this service is the special excursion to Parsley Siding.
Welcome to Parsley Sidings with Kenneth Connor, Liz Fraser, Ian Lavender, John Graham, and as the station master, Arthur Lowe. Running a railway station demands constant vigilance and forethought. As Horace Hepplewhite prepares to hold a staff meeting, there's more on his mind than just his station master's hat.
Morning, Simpkins. Where's Valentine?
He collected the tickets from the 10:30 and then went along to fetch Bert from the booking office.
I see. Talking about my son Bertrand, Miss Simpkins.
Mm-hmm.
I've been meaning to ask you a question about him for some time.
Oh?
Do you think Bertrand is happy here, Miss Simpkins?
Happy?
Yes. Is he happy at Parsley Sidings? A couple of times recently, I've noticed him behaving oddly. Kicking a sand bucket. Polishing his hat on the British Rail regulations in the waiting room, that sort of thing. Makes me wonder if he's happy with the railways.
I'm sure he is.
Fathers tend to worry, you know. In that boy's boots walks the future of British Rail. One hopes the feet in those boots are happy ones.
Well, Bert, have you handed in your notice yet, then?
No. Even the thought of it brings me out in goose pimples. I reckon I'll still be at Parsley Sidings when I'm an old maid. Well, I can't bring myself to hurt Dad, you see.
Oh.
You know, there's an old legend that when the last of the Hepplewhites leaves Parsley Sidings, the end of his platform drops off.
Yeah. There's a similar thing about Death Watch Beetle in my granddad's wooden leg. Ah, well. I wonder why the old man's called this staff meeting.
Well, I hope it's to deal with my application. I've asked for a mirror for my booking hall.
A mirror?
It gets lonely not having many customers. If I had a mirror in there, I could look in it and pretend I was different passengers buying tickets.
You... you haven't been at the Cowslip Wine again, have you?
No.
Ah, oh, Valentine and Hepplewhite, come in and sit down. I no doubt you're all agog to know why I've called this staff meeting.
Oh, yes, Mr. Hepplewhite.
This morning I had a communique from none other than St. Pancras himself.
Oh!
It advised me that the district of Parsley and Potwistle is to be incorporated into the British Rail Postal Express System.
Cool.
Did he say anything about my mirror, Mr. Hepplewhite?
I beg your pardon?
I wondered if St. Pancras mentioned my mirror at all in his communique.
St. Pancras and I have not discussed your mirror, Hepplewhite. Matters like your mirror are resolved at station master level. To continue... Jonas Bobbin, sub-postmaster at Parsley and Potwistle, has been unable to keep up with things since his tricycle failed the MOT. British Rail have therefore decided to install a rail site picking up and delivery point for express mail.
What, you mean one of those net things, you know, where the train sort of picks up a bag without slowing down and drops one at the same time?
I do indeed, Valentine.
Oh.
The 1901 patent drop-it-and-cop-it tackle.
Where will it be, Mr. Heppelwhite?
I'm very glad you asked me that. British Rail are undecided whether to erect it here at Parsley Sidings or over at Potwistle Halt.
Not Potwistle Halt.
My sentiments exactly. I feel this needs looking into.
If I looked into it, I could talk to myself. The mirror I applied for.
That'll do, Heppelwhite.
Here, how will British Rail decide which station gets this mailbag, Fiddle?
A trial run. Temporary drop-it-and-cop-it arrangements will be set up both at Parsley Sidings and at Potwistle Halt. And on Thursday, an express train will pick up and drop one at each station. The permanent fixture will go to whichever operates its equipment most successfully.
Oh, I do hope it's us, Mr. Heppelwhite.
I have every confidence that it will be, Miss Simpkins. We must watch out for sabotage from Potwistle Halt.
Sabotage? Oh, they'd never do that, would they?
Their station master, Phineas Perkins, is an unscrupulous man.
You know, to put it another way, he's so crooked he has to screw his hat on.
Exactly. And Potwistle will be desperate to win this fixture, as it carries with it a general's mail allowance. So, on your guard, everyone.
Hello, Percy. What are the binoculars for?
I'm watching out for Potwistle spies trying to meddle with our drop it and cop it.
Surely Phineas Perkins wouldn't actually meddle with our fixtures, would he?
There are people about who'd stoop that low.
Really?
Me, for instance. Yeah. I'm going to meddle with his.
Never.
What? I'm going to make Potwistle Halt look silly in front of that postal inspector. I've got a sack load of 400 eggs. Which I intend to substitute for the mailbag in their net. And when the train picks it up, it'll turn into an 80-mile-an-hour omelette.
That's really immoral.
Oh, thanks. Hello, look out, there's a train coming. Watch out for Potwistle spies.
Well, you play James Bond while I announce the train.
Right.
This is the 617 to Upper Crumpton, stopping at Waddle on Thrush, Little Nethering, Upper Warlock, and Nurdle Crumpton.
That was beautiful, Gloria.
Did you notice anyone?
Not half. Look at that blonde over there.
Did you play it by ear, Valentine, or did you have musical training?
Oh, Mr. Everwhite, I was just wondering, sir, if I should follow that young lady over there. She might be up to no good.
I hardly think that's necessary. She looks perfectly respectable to me.
Yeah.
Do you really think that Phineas Perkins will try something, Mr. Heppelwhite?
He's low and cunning, Miss Simpkins. You can tell by the fact that his eyes are set close together. He is the only person I know whose spectacles take the form of one lens on the bridge of his nose.
Mr. Heppelwhite, look, the way to make sure of this mail job is to nobble Potwistle's gear.
Valentine, are you suggesting that we at Parsley Sidings resort to underhand methods?
Yes. Now, look, I've got these eggs, you see.
Not another word. I can feel seven generations of Heppelwhites turning beneath the platform at the very idea. Let us go to the signal box. I wish to speak to Bradshaw about Thursday's arrangements. With only 2 days to go before the big day, we don't want any slip-ups. And Valentine,
sir,
I don't want to hear any more about nobbling.
All right, sir. I wonder if I could sell 400 hard-boiled eggs to the station buffet.
Ah, Bradshaw.
Ah, Master Orish. And Miss Gloria. What brings you to my signal boxing?
We've come about the drop it and cop it test.
I haven't had one of those in years. not since 1914. I failed it, you know, on account of the tea we had to drink.
I'm referring to the Postal Express collect and deposit.
Kept us fit, you know, for going over the top, you see. Main the barricades, they used to yell.
Where was this?
Paddington. They used to come at you like bats out of hell, those passengers.
Of course. You was just a nipper in, Master Otis.
To get back to the Postal Express.
I used to dandle him, you know, Miss Gloria.
Dandle?
Yes, I used to dandle him, didn't I? First on the one, up-de-do-de-do, then the other, up-de-do. Good practice for playing the spoons.
I'm sure Miss Simpkins done what
when I was away at the war, you know, I wrote to old Obadiah Applewhite to ask how little Horace was keeping. He wrote back and told me he'd grown another foot. I spent the whole war worrying whereabouts.
Did he come to keep you company in your signal box?
Never.
Oh.
Tell you what he did, you know.
Yeah?
He used to come and keep me company in my signal box.
Oh, did he?
Well, I didn't have a dog, you see. But I used to put down a bowl of water for him.
Bradshaw, we are here to acquaint you with the details of the mailbag test.
The vest
test.
What? Ah, I'll have one of them. My present one's got a hole in the elbow here. But I'd really like a pair of them combinations, you know. They used to have a trap door at the back here. So that you could get into them without difficulty.
Bradshaw.
It was all right unless you found someone else there already. But that only ever happened to me once, you know.
Bradshaw, I'm trying to tell you that we must have a clear line on Thursday. All junctions, including those of the sidings, the engine shed, the washhouse, and the Warple-Hoxton branch line, to be cut off.
Talking of them, do you know they used to use flags to signal when to change them over, you know? If you saw a flag, over went the points. They lost 14 trains one Empire Day with the local Boy Scouts practicing semaphore. And that's why the Kaiser had that trouble with his rarey bird when it died, you know.
What trouble was that, Mr. Bradshaw?
Well, you see, it was 12 foot tall. You see, and no one would bury it. So he put it on a barrow and he pushed it uphill and down dale he went, down dale and uphill he pushed. In the end, after 2,000 miles of barrow pushing, he tipped it off the cliff at John O'Groats. Oh, yes. Just goes to show you, don't it? It's a long, long way to Tipperary.
We'll leave now, Miss Simpkin.
Hello, Bert.
Oh.
What are you doing?
I'm pretending to be various customers buying railway tickets. I'll get bored with just 6 passengers a day.
Have you applied for any other jobs lately?
Well, there's no point. I'll never get away from here for fear of hurting Dad. Oh, I get ever so depressed sometimes.
Poor Bert. Is there anything I can do to cheer you up?
Such as?
Well, ask me and see if I will.
You don't mean... You don't want to?
Yes.
You wouldn't like to buy a ticket, would you?
No, not at the moment. Sorry. Oh. I must go and announce the 3:12.
Bye. A single to Nerdle Crampton, please, handsome young booking clerk. Certainly, madam. One ticket coming up. Here you are, madam.
No, thank you. I'm trying to give them up.
Oh, good heavens. Phineas Perkins. Why are you wearing a false moustache and dark glasses?
Oh, you recognise me?
Yes.
Oh, aye. Well, don't tell anyone I've called.
No.
I'm here, you see, incognito.
Are you?
Thought I'd pop in and see how the old place is keeping. Your dad and I were great friends once.
Really?
In 1926, your dad removed a conker from my ear. Using only a hammer and chisel. Now, I can help him, you see.
Oh.
This Postal Express business. What does Potwhistle Alt want with it? I've come with some advice that'll make sure you win the contract.
Advice?
It all depends on the angle you hold it.
Pardon?
Make sure the express picks the mailbag out of the net at the correct angle and you can't lose. It's one of the tricks of the trade.
Thank you, Mr. Perkins. Oh, Dad will be pleased.
No. Don't tell your father, lad. You do it and give him a surprise.
All right, Mr. Perkins. Oh, but how do I make sure it's at the right angle?
You hold it up.
Hold it up?
Yes. You wait until the last minute and then you hop forward and lift the bag.
Oh, with my hands, you mean?
That's right, lad. It can't fail.
Right, Mr. Perkins. Thanks for the tip.
Now, remember, not a word to anyone about my visit here, eh? I move in a mysterious way, you know.
Perhaps your trousers are too tight. While you're here, you wouldn't like to buy a ticket, would you?
No, thanks. I came by bus.
We don't sell bus tickets.
No, never mind, lad. I'll try elsewhere.
What a lovely day for the Postal Express, Mr. Heppelwhite.
Yes, indeed, Mr. McGinnis. Listen to those birds singing. Ah, the beauty of a country railway station.
Mm.
As a child, I used to pick flowers from the embankment. And my mother used to turn them into wine.
Really?
She gave it to the drivers of passing trains to help them on their way.
Oh, that must have pleased them.
Not as much as one would have hoped. I think the fact that she wore my father's boots to press the flowers gave it an unusual flavour.
How will this pick-up work, Mr. Heppelwhite?
The express will deposit a bag in the net and collect ours. It then proceeds to Potwitzel Halt, deposits ours there, and picks up another. The Postal Inspector Board will report on each station.
Oh, here come Bert and Percy with our mailbag.
Oh, steady with your aim, Bert.
I'm carrying both ends.
Well, I'm carrying a label.
What's in the bag, Mr. Heppelwhite?
A selection of leaflets saying, come to Sunny Past the Sidings.
Shall we sling it in a net, sir?
In the bottom net, Valentine. The top net receives our delivery.
Oh, the train's coming, Mr. Heppelwhite.
Good. Brace up, everyone. Do your best.
Yes, Mr. Heppelwhite. But what should we actually do?
Ah. Well, I suggest we all give a big cheer. On the count of hip hip, we'll all shout, hooray!
We'll call Sir Roger and out.
You can rely on me, Mr. Heppelwhite.
I sincerely hope so. Don't get too close to that net, lad. You're not insured.
Oh.
Pass the sidings. Attention! Stand by. Voices at the ready. Hip hip! Hooray! Well done, everyone. There goes our express delivery.
No, Mr. Heppelwhite. Our mailbag's still there.
What?
Stone me, so it is. What happened? Did you see what went wrong, Bert? Bert?
Good Lord. Where is the boy?
Oh, he picked up something. What is it?
Hello, Inspector.
What are you doing in our net? Where's the mailbag?
He told me to hold it, you see. He said it worked better if I stuck it out.
What are we going to do?
Uh-huh.
We'll be at Potwistle Halt within seconds and we've got nothing to deposit there.
I'm terribly sorry.
You'll be sorrier still in a moment. Look, get back in that net.
What?
You are hereby one mailbag for delivery to Potwistle Halt.
Oh, what?
Potwistle Halt coming up. Swing her out.
Hello, Mr. Perkins. Did you see the train? All covered in eggs. I think someone's played a yoke on you.
Never, Heppelwhite. Never in all my life have I been so humiliated.
I'm sorry, Father.
Silence! How can I ever again attend the station master's ball? The name of Heppelwhite will forever be associated with you in a GPO net. And to add insult to injury, I've received a bill from the post office for delivering an unstamped package. To wit, one booking hall clerk.
But, Father...
Quiet, Heppelwhite. We can only be thankful that someone switched Phineas Perkins' mailbag for one containing eggs, thus ruining their chances, too.
I reckon whoever that mysterious bag switcher is, he deserves a rise. Do you reckon, sir, that if he revealed himself, he'd get a reward?
He'd get something. Farmer Harris is looking for him with a shotgun. Matter of 400 missing eggs.
Oh, then I suppose his identity will never be known.
What happens now, Mr. Heppelwhite?
As yesterday's test was a fiasco, British Rail will hold another one tomorrow. This one we must win. It's our last chance.
What about nobbling, Mr. Applewhite?
There will be no nobbling on our part, Valentine. And to prevent Potwistle nobbling us, we shall mount a 24-hour guard on our postal apparatus.
Who'll be doing that, Mr. Applewhite?
All of us, Applewhite. Miss Simpkins and Valentine will be responsible for the rest of the day. You and I will keep watch tonight.
You mean we'll be up all night?
I do.
But if I don't get my 12 hours sleep, I'll be no good for anything tomorrow.
There'll be nothing unusual in that. I propose another safety measure also. An early warning system that will alert us at the first approach of strangers.
You're not putting Bradshaw on the roof again like you did in the war.
I am not, Valentine. We don't want another damp patch on the buffet ceiling.
Damp patch?
He kept spilling his cocoa. No, I plan to harness the highly sensitive faculties of birds.
Why?
As you know, Constantinople was saved from surprise attack by the warning call of a goose.
But we haven't got a goose, Mr. Applewhite.
We have the next best thing.
Clara, the station hen.
Exactly. That hen has a nose like a bloodhound.
Yes, the most peculiar case of crossbreeding I've ever seen.
Clara will be removed from her nest in the engine shed and allowed to roam free. Potwistle's spies will not find us unprepared.
Halt! Who went there?
It's me, you fool.
Oh.
Anything to report?
Yes.
What?
I'm cold.
Oh, never mind. What about Clara?
She's cold, too.
What was that?
Clara.
She must have seen something. Find her, quickly.
Here she is, Mr. Applewhite.
Where?
On the bookstall.
What's happened?
She's laid an egg.
Is that all? Applewhite, let us return to our post. Clara, no more false alarms, please. One can cry wolf too often. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that. Oh, what it is to have an oversensitive hen. Applewhite, whilst we're alone here and can talk freely, is there anything worrying you?
Worrying me, Mr. Applewhite?
Call me father, my boy. It's an established relationship. It's not woman trouble, is it? I know that in the past we've not had the opportunity for a heart-to-heart talk, man-to-man, father-to-son. It's possible that you're not fully aware of the... that's to say you may not quite... or possibly not at all. Forgive me if I'm being too outspoken.
Pardon?
I mean, you're not... you're not in trouble, are you?
What sort of trouble, Father?
Well, you know, like... by Jove, it is cold, isn't it? was that Clara just then?
When?
Then.
Yes.
Oh, I heard it. Tell me, Bertrand, is everything all right here?
Well, it's a bit cold.
I mean, at Parsley Sidings. The railways have always been a vocation to the Applewhites. I would hate to feel that you... You are happy on the railway.
Happy, Father?
Yes. H-A-P-P-Y.
Ah, happy.
Yes. Are you happy?
Yes.
Thank you for that reassurance, my boy. Since your mother died, you've been everything to me. Your happiness has been my sole aim.
Yes, Father.
I've scrimped and saved for you, you know. Went without. I don't want you to think that I had it easy.
No, Father.
There have been times when I've walked the platform with a hole in my shoe and thought, I'd better get it repaired. And then I thought, no, that hole in my shoe is for Bertrand.
Thank you, Father.
Oh, I don't expect gratitude, my boy. Your happiness is my reward.
Yes, Father.
You and I should talk to one another more often, Bertrand. Listening to you, opening your heart to me like this has moved me. Helped me to know you better. I feel that we've come closer to one another.
Yes, Father.
Is there anything more you wish to say to me?
Well, yes, Father. I've got a confession to make.
You can tell me, Bertrand. What is it, son?
I just sat on Clara's egg.
Oh, Lord. You're forgiven, my boy. We all make mistakes.
Thank you, Father.
However, you tend to make more than most. Tomorrow, therefore, I want you to remain in Bradshaw's signal box whilst the postal express passes through, well away from the pickup point.
Oh.
Not that I feel that you're incompetent or a danger to life and limb. Just that I would feel easier if you are nowhere near the scene of the action.
Yes, Father.
Tomorrow is a great day for past decidings, my boy. If all goes well, we shall take a bold step into the future. Oh, what a beautiful morning. The scent of new mown hay.
Actually, it's my aftershave. E-man. Slap this on and things happen to you.
What sort of thing?
Well, half your face goes numb with shock.
Is everything ready, Valentine?
Yes, sir. The label safely on the bag safely in the net, and Bert safely up the signal box. The train's due in, what, 1 minute?
Good. For once, I have a feeling that nothing can go wrong.
How long has Bert got to stay up there?
Just till the postal express is safely through.
Oh, he looks so miserable standing there with his nose pressed up against the window.
Yeah. So, you don't think that he'll do any damage in the signal box, Mr. Applewhite?
No fear of that, Valentine. Bradshaw has the strictest instructions to allow him nowhere near the levers.
Poor Bert. He tries so hard to please.
Here, Miss Simpkins, borrow my British Rail handkerchief.
Thank you. He doesn't mean any harm.
I know.
He only wants to be loved.
Wonderful view we have of the Vale from here.
Yeah.
Oh, look. Bert's waving at us.
Attention, everyone. The train.
Here, Gloria. Here, watch out where you're waving that handkerchief. You don't know where those germs have been.
Be quiet, Valentine. Attention, everyone. Shoulders back. Chests out.
Yes, Mr. Heppelwhite.
Heads up. Faces front. Now then. Hip. What's happened? Where's the train?
It's gone up the Walpole-Hoxton branch line. It's missed us altogether.
But why?
I see, sir. Bert Applewhite strikes again.
What?
When Gloria waved her hanky at him, that old fool Bradshaw thought it was a flag, the signal to switch the points.
No!
You don't often hear him say that.
He's fainted.
Oh, well, there's one constellation.
What's that?
Well, going up the Walpole Oxton branch line, it'll miss Pot Whistle Alt as well. Not really their day, is it?
Morning, Mr. Heppelwhite. Here's the post.
Thank you, Miss Simpkins. It seems British Rail Postal Services have washed their hands of both ourselves and Potwistle Holt. That was the station master at Waddle on Thrush. He rang to say they're putting their postal point there.
I am sorry, Mr. Heppelwhite.
I know where I'd like to put the point.
Oh, dear.
Let us walk up the platform to that small cabinet marked in case of emergency break glass.
What's in there?
A bottle of Parsley Siding's own cowslip wine. I shall propose a toast.
Good for you, Mr. Heppelwhite. What will it be?
To next week, Miss Simpkins. It can't fail to be better than this week. And to a bright new future for Parsley Sidings.
You ain't heard nothing yet.
George Formby was an English actor, singer-songwriter and comedian who became known to a worldwide audience through his films of the 1930s and 1940s. On stage, screen and record he sang light comical songs, usually playing the ukulele or banjo. A lot of his songs were quite risque for the time. This one of his songs is called, I'm a Wanker. Benny Hill follows with Ernie, the fastest milkman in the West.
My mother said that I never should play with the naughty, rude girls in the wood. Their giggling talk I could never understand, and that's why I fell in love with my right hand. And that's why I'm a wanker, I'm a wanker, and it does me good like it bloody well should. I'm a wanker, I'm a wanker, and I'm always pulling my pud. I was 25 years old before I was kissed, and then I found that I preferred a swift one off the wrist. It's cheap and convenient, you can't catch
BD.
It's available at any time, and it's absolutely free. And that's why I'm a wanker, I'm a wanker, and it does me good like it bloody well should. I'm a wanker, I'm a wanker, and I'm always pulling my pud. Oh, Mrs. Pond and your five lovely daughters, thank you for having me and being oh so kind. I've got pains in my arms and my donkey's growing shorter. My knees have turned to water and I think I'm going blind. I've wanked over Italy, I've wanked over Spain, I've wanked in an omnibus, I've even had a wank in a train. I've used a badger and a melon and a cat, an inflatable Linda Lovelace and a Davy Crockett hat. And that's why I'm a wanker, I'm a wanker, and it does me good like it bloody well should. I'm a wanker, I'm a wanker, and I'm always pulling my pud. Here, listen! Oh, Mrs. Tom and your five lovely daughters, thank you for having me and being oh so kind. I've got pains in my arms and my donkey's getting shorter. My knees have turned to water and I think I'm going blind. I'm a wanker, and it does me good like it bloody well should. I'm a wanker, and I'm always pulling my pud.
He's a wanker, he's a wanker, and it does him good like it bloody well should. He's a wanker, he's a wanker, and he's always pulling his pud. He's a wanker, he's a wanker, and it does him good like it bloody well should. He's a wanker, and he's always pulling his pud. He's a wanker, he's a wanker, and it does him good like it bloody well should. He's a wanker, and he's always pulling his pud. He's a wanker,
I'm a wanker,
he's a wanker,
I'm a wanker,
and it does him good like it bloody well should. He's a wanker,
I'm a wanker,
and he's always pulling his pud.
You could hear the hoofbeats pound as they raced across the ground, and the clatter of the wheels as they spun round and round. And he galloped into Market Street, his badge upon his chest. His name was Ernie, and he drove the fastest milk cart in the West. Now Ernie loved a widow, a lady known as Sue. She lived all alone in Lily Lane at number 22. They said she was too good for him, she was haughty, proud and chic. But Ernie got his cocoa there 3 times every week. They called him Ernie.
Ernie!
And he drove the fastest milk cart in the West. She said she'd like to bathe in milk. He said, all right, sweetheart. And when he'd finished work one night, he loaded up the cart. He said, you want it pasteurized, cause pasteurized is best. She says, Ernie, I'll be happy if it comes up to me chest. That tickled old Ernie. And he drove the fastest milk cart in the West. Now Ernie had a rival, an evil-looking man, called Two-Ton Ted from Teddington, and he drove the baker's van. He tempted her with his treacle tarts and his tasty oatmeal bread, and when she seen the size of his hot meat pies, it very near turned her head. She nearly swooned at his macaroon, and he said, now if you treat me right, you'll have hot rolls every morning and crumpets every night. He knew once she sampled his layer cake, he'd have his wicked way. And all Ernie had to offer was a pint of milk a day. Poor Ernie!
Ernie!
And he drove the fastest milk cart in the West. One lunchtime, Ted saw Ernie's awesome cart outside her door. It drove him mad to find it was still there at 4:30. And as he leapt down from his van, off blood to his veins did course, and he went across to Ernie's cart, and he didn't off kick his horse, whose name was Trigger. And he pulled the fastest milk cart in the West. Now Ernie rushed out into the street, his gold top in his hand. He said, if you want to marry Susie, you fight for her like a man. Oh, why don't we play cards for her, he sneeringly replied. And just to make it interesting, we'll have a shilling on the side. Now Ernie dragged him from his van, and beneath the blazing sun, they stood there face to face, and Ted went for his bun. But Ernie was too quick, things didn't go the way Ted planned, and a strawberry-flavoured yoghurt sent it spinning from his hand. Now Sushi ran between them and tried to keep them apart, and Ernie pushed her aside, and a rock cake caught him underneath his heart. And he looked up in pained surprise, and the concrete hardened crust of a stale pork pie caught him in the eye, and Ernie bit the dust. Poor Ernie!
Ernie!
And he drove the fastest milk cart in the West. Ernie was only 52, he didn't want to die. And now he's gone to make deliveries in that milk round in the sky, where the customers are angels and ferocious dogs are banned, and a milkman's life is full of fun in that fairy dairy land. But a woman's needs are manifold, and Sue, she married Ted. But strange things happened on their wedding night as they lay in their bed. Was that the trees a-rustling, or the hinges of the gate? Or Ernie's ghostly gold tops a-rattling in their crate? They won't forget Ernie!
Ernie!
And he drove the fastest milk cart in the West!
A humorous escapade. Doctor at Large debuted as a sequel to Doctor in the House. After 13 uproariously successful episodes, it became a television program. Adapted from the novel by Richard Gordon, Doctor at Large stars Richard Briers as Simon Sparrow and Geoffrey Sumner as Sir Lancelot Spratt. Doctor at Large has only had a short 13-episode radio reign.
We present Doctor at Large. Adapted for radio by Ray Cooney from the original novel by Richard Gordon, it stars Richard Briers as Simon Sparrow and Geoffrey Sumner as Sir Lancelot Spratt, with this week's special guests, Dan DeNichols as the old lady and Bill Fraser as Mr. Smith. Episode 1, The Deep End.
Come in. Ah! Sparrow, Benskin, Evans, come in. Shut the door, you horrible lot.
Morning, sir.
Sparrow!
Lovely weather, sir.
Shut up, Sparrow.
Oh, terribly sorry, sir. It's just that we're so jolly pleased to see you after the holes.
Holes?
Or holidays, Sir Lancelot. Oh,
thank you, Evans.
Well, holes is a simple abbreviation.
You'll get abbreviated if you don't shut up, Sparrow. Now, gentlemen, I use the word loosely.
I thought he used the word gentleman.
Benskin.
Terribly sorry, sir.
Last term is your final one at St. Swithin's Medical School, and you now stand before me as qualified doctors.
Oh, that was only due to your superb instructions, Sir Lancelot.
Oh, thank you, Evans, thank you.
Oh, don't mention it. Oh,
yes, you're on the threshold of your new careers. I've been studying your applications for the various vacant posts here at St. Swithin's, and I see that both you, Evans, and Sparrow have applied for the appointment of junior casualty house surgeon to the Professor of Surgery.
Well, that's right, sir. Well, you do have two, don't you, sir? I mean, there's always been two on junior casualty.
You and Sparrow work as a double actor?
Oh, no, sir, it's just that...
You've fallen in love with each other?
Oh, yes, sir. No, sir, no. We both just fancy...
Fancy what?
The idea of working with you, sir.
The damn lie. Why have you put in for junior house surgeon, Sparrow?
Why, sir? Well, sir, because I want to specialise. I want to become a surgeon.
God, help us all.
But quite frankly, sir, I feel I've got the makings of a first-class one.
I couldn't agree more. First-class what?
Surgeon, sir. I did extremely well in first year zoology, sir, cutting up the jolly old dogfish and the jolly old frogs.
Now you don't shut your jolly old trap, are you? And you, Evans.
Sir?
I suppose you also feel you have the makings of a first-class one.
Oh, definitely, Sir Lancelot, but that's only due, of course, to your excellent instruction and ever-friendly guidance.
All right. Now then, let me see. Very well, the pair of you are appointed. Report to casualty.
Great, good old chap. Simon
Boyle. Put him down, Evans, put him down. The honeymoon can wait.
Oh, sorry, sir.
Now, Benskin, I see that you've applied to be Mr. Frost's junior.
Yes, sir.
Obstetrics, eh? Would you say maternity was your line, Benskin?
You've got to be joking, sir.
Sparrow! Well, Benskin?
Well, I think so, yes, sir. I fancy it. I'd like to get some maternity benefit.
There's just some... Gosh! Shut up and report to Mr. Frost at 10 o'clock.
Yes, sir. Simon, how's it going?
Oh, hello, Tony. I'm absolutely fed up. Fed up and wet.
You would go in for surgery, old love?
What's this lot got to do with surgery?
Well, I don't know. Quite a pleasant little place for a casualty room. Bit chilly.
Chilly? I feel like Scott of the Antarctic.
You know, I don't think your get-up will actually inspire confidence in the patients.
What do you mean?
Wellington boots, duffel coat and a balaclava.
No. I'm freezing. Wretched place.
It's got what they call old world charm.
Yeah, looks like a cross between a public laboratory and an air raid shelter.
But it's hard luck, I must say. So you don't think you're cut out for surgery?
Cut out for...
I say, did I tell you the one, you know, the one about the surgeon who had his girlfriend in stitches?
No.
Well, that's it.
What is?
Maybe you shouldn't have gone in for surgery after all.
Surgery? I'm nothing more than a pen pusher, a form filler in her.
Well, I've never seen so many forms.
I know. I can't pass a patient on until the correct ones are filled in.
Well, you must be getting pretty good at diagnosing, then.
Not really. The porter diagnoses all the difficult ones.
Well, don't be downhearted. At least you're working with Taffy. Where is he?
Don't talk to me about that nasty little Welsh leek.
Well, aye, aye.
He has changed.
Has he? You better send him to me at maternity.
I wouldn't have believed it of him.
Oh, poor old Taffy. What's he done?
He pinches patients.
Pinches patients?
Yes. He's a patient pincher. In his lunch break, he wanders around stopping people in the street with promising warts and boils.
What does he do that for?
He gives them his card and tells them to ask for him personally since Witham's casual.
I see.
But it's not fair, is it? Touting for business.
Look, if you're so upset about it, why don't you pop out and collect a few juicy boils?
Because it's not considered etiquette. Come in.
Excuse me, young man.
Oh, can I help you?
Yeah, I was told to come here by the porter.
Yes.
You casualty?
Yes, Mr.
Good. But I'm seeing my own personal physician in casualty, Dr. Evans.
Dr. Evans?
Lovely lad. We got chatting in that cafe across the road over a cup of tea. I told him about my boil.
Charming.
Madam, I am on duty at the moment.
That's all right. I don't mind waiting.
You needn't wait. I'll attend to you right away.
No, I'd rather not. Dr. Evans explained you'd only just passed out.
How kind of him. Well, as this is Dr. Evans' lunch break, I'll see to him.
But Dr. Evans...
Now, sit down, please. That's it. Thank you. Now, what's the trouble? A boil, you say?
That's right.
Now, right, where is it?
I'm sitting on it.
I beg your pardon?
It's on a...
Yeah, I see what you mean. I know. Well, you'd better stand up then, hadn't you? Go behind that screen.
What can I wait for Dr. Evans?
But because I say you can't. Now, behind that screen, get your underclothes off.
Hey.
You heard.
Yeah, look, it's quite all right, Mrs.
Mrs. Muir.
Yeah, well, it's quite all right, Mrs. Muir. You see, I'll be a witness.
Witness? Witness to what?
Look, just get the things off, will you?
Dr. Sparrow has had a very busy day, Mrs. Muir. I promise you he's a very able doctor.
Who are you, then? You look about as able as he does.
Take your knickers off.
I want to know who he is if he's going to hang about witnessing my backside.
This is Dr. Benskin.
Never heard of him.
Yeah. I'm in maternity.
I'm going home.
Come back! Come back! I'll get behind that screen.
All right. Crippin'.
You see, Tony, that's the sort of thing I have to put up with all the time.
Here, this screen's got holes in it.
It doesn't matter.
Not peeking, are you?
Can't take our eyes off you. Come on, hurry up. Get on with it.
All right. Got them off.
Oh.
I'm ready.
Right.
Still think I should wait for Dr. Evans?
Look, never mind about Dr. Evans. Just lie on the table, face down.
Oh, it's not here of my own free will.
Now, I'll just lift your dress up.
Oh, God, your hands are cold.
Look, madam, if you could just stop talking for a minute while I examine your boil.
She's got a bit of a cheek, hasn't she?
Shut up.
Nothing.
Yes,
we were just having a consultation.
That's it.
The soda belt shouldn't have thought. It's plain for anyone to see.
It certainly is. pass me the knife, will you, Tony?
Oh, hi, Tony Boyle. Hi, Simon.
Here, yeah, that's my separating boil.
Oh, hello, Dr. Evans.
Well, what the hell do you think you're doing, Simon? Attending to Mrs. Muir's for uncle.
Who's he?
That's your boil.
Mrs. Muir is my patient. I've been looking forward to that boil ever since lunch. There'll be other boils when you're on duty.
Yeah, but not like this. And it's damned unethical to pinch another chap's patients, you know.
And it's damn unethical for a chap to go around the streets of London picking up his own private furunculus.
I don't think I like your tone, Simon Boyle.
And I don't very well care if you don't. Now, let me get on. Do Mrs. Muir a permanent injury.
Hey?
Now, give me that knife.
No.
All right, then I'll use my own.
Oh, no, you don't.
I sawed off fast.
I got a knickers off.
Don't start a fight on my backside.
Yes.
Stop it, the pair of you.
Get off.
Simon, come down.
My knife's there first.
It's
mine. It's mine.
Oh, heavens. What the hell do you think you're doing, Sparrow?
I'm boiling her Lancelot. laughing her boil a lot, Sir Lancelot.
Get off her, you twit.
Here, are you in charge of this lot?
Yes, madam.
Yeah, well, you'll be hearing more of this, you will. That's the sort of stuff you teach them, is it? This Welsh one procures them. This Sparrow does the job, and that horrible one stands there watching. Give me my knickers, I'm off.
How long have you been qualified, Sparrow?
About 3 weeks, sir.
Well done, Sparrow. Qualified and struck off within a month, must be a record.
It was a simple misunderstanding.
I'm glad it wasn't a complicated one. Do you usually lance a boil by jumping on a patient's posterior?
Not usually, no, sir.
You want to become a surgeon, do you?
I'm trying, sir.
You certainly are, very. And I'm surprised at you, Evans.
Oh, I'm most terribly sorry, sir.
Been showing signs of progress, too.
Oh, thank you, sir. Very kind, sir. I just don't know what came over Sparrow, sir. He seemed to go berserk. I was simply trying to save the patient further suffering.
Yes. And you, Ben Skin, I can't say I'm surprised at anything you do.
Thank you very much, sir. That's very kind.
Anyway, you're not supposed to be here at all. You're junior at the Pudding Club, aren't you?
Yes, that's right. Yeah,
well,
yes.
Get up there, then. See if anyone's coming on the boil.
All's fair in love and war, Tony.
Well, I've never seen poor old Simon look so miserable.
But he's just not cut out for surgery, you see. You've got to have a single-minded approach to it. You've got to be ruthless, see. Oh, come in.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Oh, good evening, sir. You recognize you, don't I?
Yes, Smith. Harold Smith.
Oh, yes, Mr. Smith. I've seen you before.
Indeed, and I want you to see me again.
Have you got your card from the porter?
Not yet.
Well, collect it, will you, please, and then report back.
Certainly, sir.
Oh, no.
What's up, Taff?
Oh, that Mr. Smith character.
But what about him?
Well, he's slightly around the twist.
Is he? Well, he didn't look it.
Oh, I know, perfectly harmless, but he's a hypochondriac to end all hypochondriacs. Imagines he's got a lot wrong with him. Well, he's quite well known in casualty. He's got a sort of stomach mania.
Stomach mania?
Yes, he thinks he's got all the tummy diseases going.
You mean that there's nothing really wrong with him?
No, fit as a fiddle. I had one encounter with him already. Came in saying he wanted me to operate for an appendicitis.
And did you?
Of course not. We never do. It's all in his mind. But he's in every other week asking for some sort of operation.
Blimey.
Oh, I wonder what it is this time. He's had everything from ulcers to pregnancy.
Well, I'd give him a cesarean and tell him to shut up, then.
Presented with twins, eh?
Well, I mean, why does everyone here put up with him?
Well, apparently he's stinking rich and makes very generous donations to the hospital every so often.
Ah.
That's a bit of a bind, though.
I have a green card, Doctor.
Oh, good. Come and sit down, please. Now then, what seems to be the trouble, Mr. Smith?
I need an operation.
Ah, yes, of course.
A serious operation.
Sorry, I'll see you in the pub, Taff.
Oh, hang on, Tony. I'm off duty in 5 minutes.
No, I've got a dash. You see you over there. Good night, sir.
Good night.
Well, now, Mr. Smith, if you'll just start from the beginning. Full name and address, please.
Certainly. Mr. Harold Smith, 25D Hornsey Lane, Mews, London, North 5.
North 5, thank you very much.
Good evening, Dr. Evans.
Oh, hello, Simon.
I'm a bit early. Oh, good evening, sir.
Good evening. Doctor, is it?
Yes. I'll just grab a cup of coffee, Taff. Oh, hang on a second, Simon. Don't you know Mr. Smith?
No.
Oh, don't you really? Well, Mr. Smith, Dr. Sparrow. Ah,
how do you do?
How do you do? Yeah, if you excuse me, I'll just...
No, don't go, Boyle. Look, I'm just about due off. Why don't you take over, Mr. Smith?
Aren't you in the middle of a diagnosis?
Well, no, I haven't started, but that's all right.
It's not like you, Chaff, to hurry off leaving a patient.
Well, Tony's waiting for me over the road, see? Look, you dig in, Boyle. Pains in the stomach could be interesting.
It's very decent of you, Chaff.
Well, share and share alike, that's my motto.
Dr. Sparrow will look after you, Mr. Smith.
I'm most kind.
Ah, well, now, sir, now, let me see. I see Dr. Evans has taken down your particulars. Now, Hornsey Lane Mews, very nice.
That is most congenial.
Yes. Now, what seems to be the trouble?
I want an operation.
I beg your pardon?
I want an operation.
Well, yes, well, let's see if there's anything wrong with you first, eh? Then we'll pass you on to the necessary specialist and he can decide.
I want my operation tonight.
You? Tonight?
I've been having these pains, intermittent abdominal.
Intermittent ab... Oh, yes, I see.
And now they're worse, mostly sub-umbilical.
Umbilical. Oh, yes, sub meaning under the umbilical, the umbilical, yes.
Here.
Oh, yeah, tummy ache.
If only it was.
You don't appear to be in very much pain, Mr. Smith.
Are we alone, Doctor?
Alone? Yes. Well, I think so, yes. Why?
But if you don't arrange for my operation tonight, it could prove disastrous.
Disastrous?
You're Sir Lancelot Spratt's house surgeon, aren't you?
Well, yes, the junior one. One of two.
Well, it's like this, Doctor. I've had reason to call at St. Swithin's on numerous occasions over the years.
Yes?
Yes, I've had dozens of operations. Oh, dozens of them.
Good God.
But the last one was 6 months ago when Sir Lancelot Spratt operated on me. It was a sort of partial gastrectomy.
Gastrectomy?
Yes. Now, everything was all right.
Splendid.
Until a couple of days ago.
What happened then?
The pains. Tonight after supper, I coughed. And I found something hard in my throat.
Something hard?
It was a nut.
A nut?
A nut.
Peanut, walnut?
Metal nut.
A metal nut?
5 minutes later, I produced a screw.
Where from? Oh, you were coughing, I suppose.
After that, up comes two more nuts.
Metal?
Metal. Followed by a bolt and a piece of spring.
What? That's absolutely fantastic.
Do you know what these bits and pieces were from?
No.
A surgical retractor.
A surgical? Well, this is awful. Appalling. Yes. Catastrophic. Yes. Sir Lancelot has always said that this is the worst disaster that can befall a surgeon. Cut their throats, yes. But leave anything inside them and you're in the Sunday papers in no time. Quartz damages the lot.
Oh, it's lovely. It's exciting, isn't it?
Exciting. Do you realize you've got a spring-loaded retractor floating around inside you?
I've got some of it up. Hold on a minute, I think another bit's coming up.
Hold on.
No, it's all right, it isn't.
We must keep calm. We mustn't tell anyone else about this, Mr. Smith. It must be a secret. Sir Lancelot must be informed immediately. Heavens, if this got out, I'll organise the operating theatre at once. Now lie down on the couch, Mr. Smith, please.
Oh, thanks, Dr. Smith. Oh. I'm so glad I got you tonight.
Yes. Sister? Dr. Sparrow, casualty, yes. Arrange for an emergency operation immediately. I'm afraid I can't tell you what for. Look, please, don't be difficult, sister. Look, no, Sir Lancelot himself will perform the operation. Now, where is he? What? See who? Giselle? Well, he'll have to leave her and get... Oh, Giselle, the valet. Well, I'll have to go and drag him out. Where's his arm? What? You what? Look, I don't care if it is a royal gala. No, nobody else can do it. Look, he's in casualty at the moment, and I want him prepared for an emergency, an abdominal operation.
A laparotomy.
What? Oh, yes, thanks. A laparotomy, yes. No, nobody, no. Just the theatre sister. I'll assist Sir Lancelot, yes. Hello, are you still there? Oh, good. Look, I want the patient on the table in half an hour, and remember, the utmost secrecy. Now, don't move, Miss Smith. I'll be as quick as I can.
I hope you find Sir Lancelot all right.
Don't worry, I will. This is my chance to show him I have got the makings of a first-class one.
Thank you. Shh!
Excuse me. I'm sorry. Sir Lancelot.
What the hell are you doing here?
I'm terribly sorry.
Don't mind sitting down, please.
But there's nowhere to sit.
Well, get down on your knees. Everybody in the royal box is looking at you.
Hmm? Hello.
That's better. Now, what's the meaning of this parrot?
Could you come outside immediately, sir?
No, I couldn't buzz off.
You've got to get to the theatre right away.
I'm in the theatre, you're raving at it.
Then to the hospital. You've got to do a lap or something or other immediately.
I'm watching the ballet. Go away, crawl off. You're drunk. I'll have your guts for stitches and all.
Please, it's an emergency operation.
There are half a dozen surgeons on duty. Now go away, you intoxicated wretch.
You'll be hurt.
It's not me, it's him.
You better crawl out with me, sir.
I'm watching the ballet.
I'm only doing this for you. I am trying to save you the Sunday papers.
I don't want the Sunday papers. I want to watch yourself.
Look, sir, you might have to wait several years if you don't remove what's left of your spring-loaded retractor from Mr. Smith's stomach.
And if you don't remove your... Eh? My retractor? Somebody's stomach?
Yes.
Move over, Sparrow. We'll discuss this under the seat.
Right.
Sparrow, let's have it.
I got Mr. Smith being prepared for an immediate operation.
Smith? Smith? Never heard of him.
You did a gastrectomy on him a short while ago.
Did I? I can't remember. I must have performed dozens of operations on people called Smith.
Anyway, that's beside the point. This one is coughing up your retractor.
I see. Yeah, I suppose it's possible. Left an occasional swab inside, but never anything like a retractor. Yeah, I'd better get back and have a look at him. Must be getting careless. Good retractor's damn expensive.
Come on.
Excuse me, will you? You bow, you fool. Bow the robot. Not to me, you fool. To the royal box.
Oh, this is outrageous.
Morning, Simon. Waiting to see old Fanny Spratt?
Yes. He summoned Taff and me for 9:30. Taff's in there now.
Yes. Sorry to hear about your spot of bother last night. Most unfortunate.
It was ghastly.
Very sad. Some of the staff are still laughing, actually.
I'll never forget it till my dying day.
Well, if Fanny has his way, you might forget pretty soon.
But can you picture it? The quiet of the operating theatre. Just the anaesthetist, the sister, Sir Lancelot, and me assisting. I could see me getting in the medical journal. I could see an ever-grateful Sir Lancelot presenting me with a gold watch. And then Mr. Smith was wheeled in, out to the world with a silly grin on his face. Sir Lancelot turned to me and said, "Pull back the sheet, Sparrow. We'll open up his scar and go in the same way as before." I pulled back the sheet. No scar. Ghastly. I looked. I searched. We both looked. That wretched Mr. Smith had never had an operation in his life. Mind you, from the way Sir Lancelot acted, I thought he was going to operate out of spite.
Yeah, but, you know, Mr. Smith was very lucky.
Not on him, on me.
Oh. Well, he's ready for you, Simon.
Oh, thanks.
Simon.
Yes?
I'm sorry, Boyle.
What for?
Well, I behaved pretty badly, but I didn't mean to end up as disastrously as it did last night.
Oh, that's all right, Taff. I behaved like a complete and utter idiot.
Well, anyway, I told Fanny that I was partly to blame.
Oh, no, you shouldn't have done that.
Look, put it there, Boyle. Let's shake.
Of course.
Stop behaving like a couple of pansies.
Sorry, sir.
Come on, Sparrow, waiting for you. Tear off, Evans, and you, Benson.
Right, yes, sir.
Sure, you hang around Sparrow and Evans like a ruddy midwife. Come on in, you horrible Sparrow. Now, what have you got to say for yourself, eh?
Do you think it's too late to take up farming, sir?
Let you loose on those poor defenseless animals?
Yes, yes. Tell you the truth, sir, I don't really think I'm cut out to be anything.
Well, unfortunately, the one thing that you're least cut out for is the one thing you qualified in.
Yes, sir.
I've always said it was a miracle how you passed your finals.
Yes, sir, you have always said that.
Not that there's anything really wrong with your brain.
It's very kind of you to say that, sir.
You're just totally unequipped to deal with life.
That's it, sir. That's just it.
Stop agreeing with me, blast you.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
Yes, life, Sparrow. That's what medicine's all about.
Well, I can't agree there.
Don't argue with me, you insolent boy.
No, sir. Sorry, sir.
It's not medical knowledge you lack, Sparrow. It's knowledge of life. You're gullible, innocent, and... What's the word I'm looking for?
Stupid?
That'll do, yes. Look at that business last night.
I'm most terribly sorry.
You should never have allowed yourself to be taken in by the fella. Why didn't you ask to see his bits and pieces?
I beg your pardon?
That's what I mean. Why didn't you ask him to produce these nuts and bolts he said he'd coughed up?
I didn't think.
Why didn't you examine his stomach?
I didn't think.
Sure, honestly, Sparrow, if you had twice as much sense, you'd still be a half-wit.
You're absolutely right, Sir Lancelot. Why don't I chuck medicine altogether?
Now, that's your other trouble. No guts, no staying power. That's you, Sparrow. Too gullible, no staying power.
Too gullible, no staying power.
But you're loyal, you're honest, and you're dependable.
Am I?
Yes. And if I have you around me for another week, you'll drive me to drink.
Well, I wouldn't want to do that, sir.
So I have devised a scheme whereby your knowledge of life will be increased immeasurably, your guts will be tested daily,
Your loyalty will be appreciated enormously, and I can get rid of you permanently.
It sounds splendid, sir.
I'm glad you think so. Append your signature to these papers. You're signing on as doctor to the merchant ship SS Lotus.
That is jolly good. Why aren't you laughing, sir?
You've got 7 days to get your passport sorted out and your jabs.
Jabs? Sir, you couldn't.
I have. Sign there, Sparrow. A round trip to Australia will make a man of you.
Australia?
Yeah, should be a big success with the kangaroos.
But sir, I've never been further out to sea than Canby Island.
Fine.
Honestly, sir, my knowledge of seafaring is based on the serpentine rowing boats and a very small part in the hospital production of Treasure Island.
Fine.
I won't. Now, look here, Mr. Christian. Sir Lancelot. I know my rights.
Either you sign, Sparrow, or I shall give you such hell for the remainder of your time here, you'll wish you'd signed on as a boy cadet.
Where do I sign?
That's our stuff. There, Sparrow. The company have attached this as well. Better fill that in while you're at it.
What is it?
Last will and testament. This will make a man of you, Sparrow. Did me...
Were you a ship's doctor, Sir Lancelot?
Yes, did 4 trips just after I qualified. Wonderful stuff. You'll learn more about medicine on board ship than you ever will here. The thing some of those sailors... Yeah, but it's another story. By the time you get back, Sparrow, you'll be a different person.
I can believe that, sir.
You'll be able to go into practice anywhere in the country with confidence.
But I still intend to sit for my fellowship, sir. Become a surgeon.
I wouldn't advise it, Sparrow. Not really the job for a young man who lances boils by jumping on patients' backsides.
Yes, sir, but you know...
And would happily perform an abdominal operation on a nutcase.
Well, that...
And I shall remember to my dying day you diagnosing a boiled sweet stuffed up a little boy's nose as a gangrenous carbuncle.
But those things could happen to anyone, sir.
Not to anyone, Sparrow.
Oh, well, sir... Worst things happen to sea. What am I saying?
Good day, Sparrow. Oh, don't forget to say goodbye before I leave.
How'd it go, Simon?
Oh, Tony.
Are you all right, old love?
No, I feel seasick.
You don't look too good. You weren't sacked, were you?
No, shanghaied. Come on, splice the main brace. I need a double run, at least.
A double run? Simon.
In this episode of Doctor at Large, written by Ray Cooney, the parts were played as follows. Simon Sparrow, Richard Breyer, Sir Lancelot Spratt, Geoffrey Sumner, Tony Benskin, Ray Cooney, Taffy Evans, Edward Cass, The Old Lady, Dandy Nichols, Mr. Smith, Bill Fraser. Doctor at Large was adapted from the original novel by Richard Gordon and produced by David Hatch.
This is the pilot episode of The News Quiz, which was first broadcast in 1977 with Barry Norman as chairman. Later, it was chaired by Simon Hoggart. Barry took until 1995, and then again by Simon Hoggart until March 2006. Hogarth was replaced by Sandy Toksvig in September 2006, who in turn was replaced by Miles Jupp in September 2015. The series was created by John Lloyd based on an idea from Nicholas Parsons.
We present the News Quiz, and here's the chairman, Barry Norman.
Well, thank you, and welcome to the News Quiz, or if you prefer, keep taking the tabloids. What it amounts to is this. I shall be asking questions about people, events and places in the news this week, and the panel will provide the answers. At least I hope they'll provide the answers, because if they don't, we're in for a very short programme. Anyway, on our panel tonight, we have Mr. Richard Ingrams, TV critic of The Spectator, and as editor of Private Eye, the scourge of the establishment. Alongside him, we have the scourge of practically everybody else, the columnist of the Daily Mail, Mr. Nigel Dempster. And with him, we have the film critic of The Observer, Mr. Russell Davies, and beside him, the deputy editor of Punch, Mr. Alan Coren. To start with, here are some fairly straightforward questions about some events that have happened in the last 7 days. I'll award 2 points for each correct answer, and if the person of whom it is asked doesn't know it, I will throw it open to anybody else, who can then collect 2 bonus points for himself. So I'll start with Richard Ingrams. I'd like you, Richard, if you would, to listen to the mellifluous voice of John Marsh and tell me what is
the biggest case of highway robbery since Dick Turpin terminated his ignominious career.
That's probably a politician talking about the budget, is it?
That's close enough. Actually, it's the budget as seen by the chairman of the RAC.
Good enough, yes.
Good enough, yes. Two marks. Nigel Dempster, who has a car with the number ADO88, and why isn't it going anywhere?
Good God. I've been training as Britain's first astronaut for the last week, and we've been in a ADO88. It's clearly Margaret Thatcher, I mean.
Yes, a lady. And she's not going anywhere, as we all know. These are lies. These are lies that have been printed about her winning elections. Clearly press propaganda.
That's a very beautiful answer, but unfortunately it's wrong. Does anybody else know? ADO 88, and it's not going anywhere. Alan Coren.
I think it's the first number of the new Mini, which isn't going to come off the Leyland assembly line.
Oh, a big hand, please, for Mr. Alan Coren. Very good. You've been reading the papers. Haven't you anything better to do?
I've been ordering minis. I'm told it's only a 14-year waiting list for a Cortina, or I shall go for that instead.
On now, then, to Di Davis. Di, where was one foot uncomfortable while another was standing?
I was thinking the ring at Wembley with John H. Tracy, but failing that, Stetchford. Am I right? Paul Foote.
Doing well.
40.
Doing well.
The socialist worker candidate. And the oldest candidate in the race, according to one of the papers, was standing, and Mr. Foote came down to support the Labour candidate who lost.
Indeed, it was at Birmingham Stetchford, where Michael Foote's nephew, Paul Foote, was standing against the Labour Party as candidate for the Socialist Workers' Party. And he got, as you know, 377 votes and lost his deposit. So I don't suppose Uncle Mike was all that bothered, except in a perhaps avuncular way.
He'd be asking for his job back on Private Eye.
Will you give it to him?
Yes.
Won't make his deposit.
Well, there you are, Paul Foote. All is not lost. Alan Coren, who stood near the smoke that thunders and said,
ah,
and then said,
ah,
again?
You did that very nicely. The smoke that thunders is the only thing that I can... I think it's Niagara, the smoke that thunders, isn't it? Isn't it the Arapaho word, or possibly the Pawnee word for that? The smoke that thunders is a translation of an Indian term for something else.
Russell Davies, Di Davies.
It's the Queen running away from a native dance in Papua New Guinea very fast.
No, I'll tell you the answer. It's President Podgorny of the USSR on his recent trip to Zambia when he looked at Rhodesia across the Victoria Falls and said, ah, twice.
You're not giving me half a point for four.
I think he should not.
Half a point for four. Well, hang on. Yeah, half a point for Forsyth.
Half
a point,
Mr. Corrigan for Forsyth.
Those were the President's only recorded remarks, and I should think they will make the shortest recorded entry in the Oxford Dictionary of Quotations. Well, now we come to a roundabout people, people of whom some rather waspish comments have been made in the news this week. 2 points again for identifying the victim. First, for you, Richard Ingrams, who does this refer to?
He's been given just one glimpse of the black underwear of power, and he's not been able to take a grip on himself. He needs to take a few cold baths.
It's not Nigel Dempster.
No. The black underwear... again, it's sufficiently bad, I think, to be a politician. And it sounds to me someone attacking someone in the Liberal Party. Possibly John Pardew, who's been on the television again a lot.
Yes, right? you're doing rather well. Yes, it was.
But
indeed.
I don't know who made the attack.
Well, it wasn't a politician. It was a fellow scribe, one Frank Johnson, in Thursday's Daily Telegraph. And he was indeed talking about John Pardew. 2 marks for Richard Ingrams.
Quite brilliant.
I should come to John Pardew's defence, because I was at school with him and he never wore black underwear.
But he may have seen yours.
Well, this is...
Was he also expelled?
We'll draw a veil over.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Please, let us get on. Nigel Dempster, who is the connection between this sort of thing...
Yike! I've been tricked! Here comes Porky Brown! Snarl. Make a fool of me, would you? Boo!
And this sort of thing.
Transition from the first to the second stage shall be conditional upon a confirmatory statement to the effect that the essence of the objectives laid down in the treaty for the first stage has in fact been achieved and that all obligations have been observed.
It's quite obvious who this is. Quite obvious. It's George Thompson, who was the EEC commissioner, who's now Lord Thompson, who used to be, well, the Nigel Dempster of Dandy, famous magazine that I used to take as a child.
You're absolutely right.
That's absolutely brilliant.
Absolutely right.
His greatest invention was Corky the Cat, spelt with two K's. Yes, and this is obviously the sort of man that should be in charge of our welfare. And
he's in the House of Lords now, I presume.
In the House of Lords.
With everyone else.
With Lord Kagan, yes, and Lady Falkenberg.
Well, we don't want to drag them.
Well, indeed. Indeed, that was reported in the Times Diary on Wednesday, just before he took his seat in the House of Lords, along with Lord Snooty and his pals. Now then, Di Davis, who was described this week as...
A man whom I tend to confuse with Robin Ray. He comes across as quite a nice young man who would make a rather reassuring dental assistant.
A rather reassuring dental assistant. Large fluorescent teeth. Who on earth would that be? It's not Andy Williams, is it? No, it's not.
Could be, but it isn't
at the moment. Who did he remind the person of?
Robin Ray.
Music and teeth. It's Heath. It's got to be Edward Heath. But
that's a nice guess, but it's wrong again.
It isn't David Steele, is it?
Yes, it is.
It is.
It is David.
Oh.
I'm surprised you didn't get this immediately, Richard, because it was David Steele as lampooned by Peter Cook in his Monday
That's
column
right.
in the Daily Mail.
I knew I'd seen it. Good old Cook.
We'll give him a couple of bonus points anyway, Francis. Alan Coren, of whom has this been said?
Some pella people ting quin got plenty money. Triple a big pella house, no mass work.
I was listening to the mellifluous oriental, semi-oriental stuff. It's somebody in Melanesia or the Solomon Islands or Guadalcanal or that way.
Well, which?
She's been to so many places, I don't know. It's like victory at sea, trying to follow the Queen.
Well, first of all, Alan, let's take
Iwo
it bit
Jima.
By bit.
The of Queen landing on Iwo Jima.
That's exactly. It was said, indeed, of Big Fella Quinn in a Papua paper during the state visit there. Oh. And also, apparently, she was reported to be charmed by the descriptions in the local pidgin English of a calf as a piccaninny belong Big Mukau, and drunk, which in Papuan comes out as long, long, long whiskey. What are the scores, Francis, at this stage? Well, the position is this. Richard Ingrams has 8 points, Nigel Dempster has 9, Di Davies has 5, and Alan Coren is leaping ahead with 11.5.
Yeah. Good. Very nice. The mature tomatoes are good, you know. Mm.
Di, you had 5 at the end of the last round. What happened?
Well, I only read the Thetford and Wotton Chronicle, and none of it.
Well, perhaps you'll catch up on this. This is a musical round. I'm going to play you each a piece of music which is directly or obliquely connected with something that's happened this week. I'll give you 1 point for identifying it and another for answering a question about it. Richard Ingrams, who doesn't know what this is?
I don't.
That's not the right answer. You're not getting a point for that.
Is it Edward Heath conducting the orchestra very badly?
It might have been, but isn't. Alan Coren.
The bloke who doesn't know is Noel Annan. That's, in fact, the Jimmy Young signature rubbish.
Absolutely
and
right.
Noel Annan's in.
See, that shows me to be a man of distinction, you see.
It obviously shows you to be a man who's qualified to look into broadcasting, doesn't
yes,
it?
Yes.
Nigel Dempster, where would you have had to go this week and when to hear this melody?
I realise now that I'm here under false pretences, and I didn't admit that I was tone deaf when I signed up for this. That is Edward Heath, of course, conducting the triumphal march of the socialist candidate into no, not at all.
Alan Coren.
Yes, it is the theme music of Peyton Place, which has been spooling out again in fearful Yorkshire, where Paul Fox is doing an experiment into early indigestion by putting on breakfast time television. And it's all those terrible old people from Connecticut who are going through their routines again, isn't it?
I'm getting thoroughly bored with saying this, but Alan Coren is quite right yet again.
Yeah.
It is indeed the signature tune from the continuing, or as I like to think of it, the interminable story of Peyton Place.
Yorkshire
Television will be putting it out at breakfast time.
I think
Alan
ought to
be able to tell us in 30 seconds what actually happened in Peyton Place.
it doesn't take 30 seconds.
It does.
It turns out to be a very down-market programme, we're pleased to say this.
Did they get married and live happily ever after?
No, the very old man carries on getting very, very old and actually outlives them all. He is then the only person left in Peyton Place, and all the others who are divorced.
So there's now no point in going up to Yorkshire to watch the continuing song. Story.
No,
we know
no.
the answer. Right, Di Davies, here's your piece of music. Now, why might that be the sound of somebody blowing out candles? It doesn't sound remotely like anybody's blowing out candles, but why might it be the sound of somebody blowing out candles?
Wasn't Don Revy pirouetting onto the field to celebrate his third anniversary as England's manager, was it? No, I should have thought it was probably Sir William Walton celebrating what I believe to be his 75th birthday, and that was probably a bit of his facade.
Absolutely correct, yes. Perfectly correct.
I knew that too, actually.
Well, you should have said.
Well.
Alan Coren, for you. Now, we know all know that's the Beatles, but what have the numbers 5, 150, and 827,850,000 got to do with that?
I think it's got something to do with Beethoven's birthday. That was Beethoven's 150th. He was 5 last week. Something like that.
Totally correct so far. Your figures are a little different, perhaps.
8,000 million. That's the age of the universe.
No.
The golden disc
has just been reassessed.
You haven't even been listening, have you? It wasn't 8,000 million. It's 827,850,000. Di Davies.
That's the population of China, isn't it? 827 million. 827 million is the population of China.
Yes. And to the nearest 10 million or so,
been
yes.
rehabilitated.
Absolutely.
Brilliant.
As, a, yes. oh, as an accepted chap after being condemned as a bourgeois something or other for donkey's years.
That's absolutely true. The music we heard, of course, was Beethoven's 150th symphony, as Alan Corrin said, on the occasion of Beethoven's 5th anniversary. And the population of China is 827,850,000, and it was indeed in China this week, where, to coincide with the anniversary, Beethoven was removed from the blacklist of bourgeois composers.
Very good. No.
You're doing so badly, Di, I'll give you another bonus point.
Oh, thank you,
Barry.
Thank you, Barry.
Actually, at this point, you're doing rather better than Richard. Richard Ingram's got 8, Nigel Dempster's got 9, Di Davis, thanks to my generosity, has now got 9, and Alan Corrin is ludicrously, obscenely ahead with 16.5 points.
Resign.
And now we come to our mystery guest. Good evening, mystery guest.
Good evening.
Well, the object tonight is for you, the panel, to discover where our mystery guest comes from and why he has cause to celebrate this week. Now, his answers, as you'll discover, will be on the monosyllabic side. But never fear, if you seem to be struggling, I might just be prevailed upon to throw the odd clue your way. 5 points, then, to whoever guesses the guest's country of origin and the reason for his celebration. And for you at home, here is his identity.
And the mystery guest is Ralph Baskerville, leader of the opposition in the Guardian's imaginary islands of Sans Serif. An April Fool hoax.
Richard Ingrams.
Well, are you one of us? Are you British?
No. Oh. No. I think we should come to the point immediately. Are you Lord Lucan?
He obviously is a fan. No.
No.
No, he's not Lord Lucan.
He's clearly a foreigner.
He was a foreigner.
He had to seek advice as to who this man
You've
was.
Wasted your question.
Di Davis.
Should we think of you as a cultural rather than political person?
I would not have said that, no.
Alan Corrin.
I want to recap on that answer. I mean, he is not cultural, he is political, or he's neither. Or...
Well, he said it funny anyway.
Are you here, since this is broadcasting, are you here to promote something, as it were, a book or a mistress or a film? Are you Barry's publisher?
I am here, in a sense, to promote a country.
Yes.
A country which is at present in the news.
Do you come from Luxembourg? If you did come from Luxembourg, you would be pleased at having only lost 5-0.
That is not a question, I think.
It's definitely the man who we all should welcome to this country on June the 2nd for the Jubilee celebrations, President Amin.
It's paled beneath his tan, you mean?
No, it isn't. It must be. Is it Sherpa Tenzing?
No.
Well, it is my turn now.
Go on, come
yes,
on.
If I said the word sans serif, would they mean anything?
That is indeed my country.
You work for the fearful Groniad?
No, I do not work for the Groniad.
I think I'll have to stop you now, Alan. Damn you, you've gone and guessed it again. He is indeed from the country of Sans Serif. And Sans Serif, as some of you will know, was featured in 7 pages of The Guardian this morning, and it doesn't exist.
Rather like the other 6 pages
Fool's
of
joke.
The Guardian.
I'll ignore that. And our guest here is, in fact, the leader of the opposition in Sans Serif. His name is Ralph Baskerville, and he's 89 years old. Now that Alan Corran has gone and spoiled the game, Mr. Guest, would you like to tell everybody who you really are?
Geoffrey McGiven. How do you do?
Hello.
I think the 54.5 million people in this country who don't get The Guardian should have seen this marvellous picture of him with a blanket round him, and it said, the leader of the opposition going into Parliament House. It was a bit of a crib, because that's just how Margaret Thatcher looks most afternoons.
So now we come to an open round, just to add a frisson of excitement to the closing stages of our game. Open to anybody, fingers on the buzzers, please. Now then, first question, where all last week could you have seen several white nuns, some pink giants, and a ballerina? Nigel Dempster.
My office. I was auditioning for a secretary.
You're suffering from a hangover again.
No, that's not the right answer.
Well, I'm not a balletomane, but was it Sleeping Beauty at...
No, that's not the right answer either.
We must get one before Corran gets it.
Yes. It's disgraceful.
He's simmering. Steam is coming out of his ear.
I know.
Several white nuns, some pink giants, and a ballerina. Corran is simmering, as everybody else says, yes. I think if he doesn't get this right, I'll take some marks away from him.
A lot.
Oh, well, you're obviously not going to get it.
Are they sorts of drink?
No, alas, no, they're not. No, as a matter of fact, they're flowers. And you could have seen them at the Royal Horticultural Society show at the New Hall, Westminster.
I'm glad Corran didn't get it anyway.
Nobody got any points for that.
God.
What now are the precautions taken by the Vicar of Christchurch, Lancaster Gate? Nobody? Not a guess?
Well, he probably sort of does his sermons in a crash helmet because there's masonry falling around or something like that, you know?
That's inspired, Nigel. That's absolutely inspired. He does indeed wear a crash helmet while delivering his sermons. And the reason he wears his crash helmet is that the church has been declared a dangerous structure, and he fears that things may fall on him from above.
Yeah. See, he can make up a story, and it's true. That's a great genius of a great journalist.
No, you had read that, Nigel, hadn't you? You were just shy to tell me. Before.
No, I've
made it up, and it was true. That's what he does all the time.
I haven't read a paper all week.
What's this man on about, and why?
Ah, well, now I like all puddings, particularly ones I haven't tried before very often, but I suppose Orange Boodle Fool is a very great standby. And in my home, we're very, very good on Queen's pudding. I'm fond of almost every sort of pudding. I like roly-poly puddings, suet puddings, and treacle puddings I'm fond of.
Anybody?
It's one of Corran's colleagues. It's a cheating question.
One of his younger colleagues. Isn't it?
It's the obese thespian, Mr. Robert Morley, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yeah. I'm not entirely sure that Robert Morley would like to be described as obese. Well-built is perhaps more
I think he's a practicing thespian.
Well, thespian, certainly thespian. Well, maybe thespian. Now then, I'll give you a point for that, but what was he doing?
He was making himself even more obese. Eating all these puddings.
Any more nasty remarks like that, and I'll take your point away. What actually was he doing? Does anybody know?
He certainly wasn't commenting on the lunch at Punch.
No, he was
he's probably plugging a
pudding
book.
Year.
He's plugging his book.
It must be something to do with the Silver Jubilee. They're giving away several million silver puddings. It's Josiah Wedgwood pudding set. It's got to be something to do with the Jubilee.
Yes. They're launching British puddings into space.
It gives me great pleasure to deny you all a point for that. I will give Richard Ingram's one for guessing that it was Robert Morley. And he was acting as the great English pudding taster on behalf of the English Tourist Board's campaign, A Taste of England, to promote more English dishes in restaurants. And he did all that on Tuesday at the Fishmongers Hall in London. Why would it have been somewhat pointless to write to people who live in Enfield last week?
Is it because their MP is Reginald Maudling?
No, it's not. No, it's not.
It's just that on the day of the budget, I saw Reggie drinking champagne and eating well. Doesn't go to the
What's that got to do with the people of Enfield? Why is it pointless to write to the people who live in Enfield last week? You're waffling again, Dempster.
Because the postmen are on strike, aren't they?
Ah, well, no, that's not exactly the answer I wanted. No, it isn't, no. Anybody else like to give me an answer? You're getting close, you're getting warm.
It's All the letterboxes have been bricked up.
I think the last literate man in Enfield died.
Yeah. I just hope you don't go to Enfield too soon, Alan. No, the answer is that Ian Church, who was a 19-year-old postman, decided he didn't want to deliver his mail in the rain, so he took all the letters home and burned them. And he was fined £150 and ordered to pay £90 costs at Tottenham on Monday. I should think, actually, people in Enfield were probably quite glad not to get their income tax bills and all that. No points for that, for anybody, nobody, no. Now, what was a mechanic doing with a postman, a council worker, a teacher, a garage clerk and four steel workers on Wednesday night? I don't want any disgusting answers.
I think this is the Annan Committee again. Returning to deliberate on some major television topic.
Could we have the composition again?
Of course, of course. A mechanic, a postman, a council worker, a teacher, a garage clerk and four steel workers.
Yes, this is the football match. This is the England team to meet Luxembourg. Possibly vice versa.
I think I like your first answer so much better, I'll give you 3 points for that. It was, in fact, the Luxembourg team, but it couldn't have been the English team because it didn't mention any plumbers. Well, that's what we've discovered in this week's papers, and now I'm going to throw the ball into the panel's court and ask them what they've discovered in this week's papers. Richard Ingram.
Well, I have... Yeah, as David Frost used to say, I've just been sent a cutting from the Edinburgh Evening News, which says that during her 20-minute tour, the Princess spoke to a plaque commemorating 65-year-old Mr. Jack Dornan of Albert Street.
Well, I find that it's becoming extremely difficult to feed oneself with the cost of living going up it is, and the Putney Roehampton Herald tells us that the result of a prosecution of a man who waded into Barnes Pond and still flees from the surface of the water was a £1 fine. Not even nutritious, I'm told.
Di Davis.
Well, there was nothing in the Thetford and Watton Chronicle, so I had to read Time Out. I found a small ad which I'd advise readers not to reply to. It says, roll up, special offer, sod all, yours for only £1.
And in these days of inflation, cheap at the price. Yes. Alan Corrin.
I have one from the Sheffield Morning Telegraph. It says, on the first visit, said Mr. Hodgkinson, they found the family pet, a ginger cat, sitting on a work surface among uncooked fish and meat pies. When Mrs. Allen was told it constituted an offence under the food hygiene regulations, she threw the cat out of the window. Would you like one from the Luton Evening Post?
Oh, please, please.
Because it beggars everything, including description. Great Dane enthusiasts are worried about the image of the breed. One said, it would be tragic if Great Danes became associated with pornography in the mind of the public.
They write a lot of that, do they? Gentlemen, thank you. That brings us to the end of this quiz on the news. And now, here are the main points again. Richard Ingram's 9, Nigel Dempster 9. Russell Davies, 12, and Alan Corrin, 21.5. Congratulations then to Alan Corrin, who is the winner of this week's Star Prize, a second-hand copy of yesterday's Morning Star. Till next week, keep taking the tabloids. Goodbye.
Taking part in the news quiz were Alan Corrin, Russell Davies, Nigel Dempster and Richard Ingrams. The chairman was Barry Norman and the programme was devised and produced by John Lloyd and Danny Greenstone.
A Life of Bliss was introduced by the BBC on the 29th of July, 1953, starring George Cole as awkward, absent-minded bachelor David Bliss in the early episodes. Nora Swinburne played his sister, Pamela Batten and Esmond Knight, his brother-in-law, Robert Batten. Later on, these roles were absorbed by Diana Churchill and Colin Gordon. This series ran for 118 episodes before it moved to television in the early 1960s. This episode is from the 20th of October 1954.
The BBC presents A Life of Bliss. Being another episode in the life of David Alexander Bliss, better known to us as George Coe. Helping him to tell the story are Diana Churchill, Colin Gordon, Gladys Young, Petula Clark, Gladys Henson, Ernest Jay, Percy Edwards, Ruth Trouncer, Elsa Palmer, and the BBC Variety Orchestra conducted by Paul Fenolet. Although terribly shy and still a bachelor, David Bliss feels lost without a girlfriend, just as his daily help, Mrs. Griffin, would feel lost without a chat to her next-door neighbour.
Has your Mr. Bliss found himself another girlfriend yet?
Good gracious, no. Not that he's looking for one, really. He's just waiting and hoping.
He's got hope. Pretty girls don't go on trees.
It wouldn't make no difference to him if they did. After all, you know what he's like.
How do you mean?
He'd be too scared to pick one and end up with a windfall.
And so over to his flat to meet the man himself, David Alexander Bliss.
There we are, home again. Go on then, in you go.
I thought I heard the door.
Oh, hello, Mrs. Griffin. We've been for a walk in the park.
Whatever's come over you? You've been out early every morning this week.
Well, I always take Psyche for a walk before I go to the office.
Of course you don't.
I do, you know.
You don't?
I do. You keep out of this.
There you are. You see, she knows I'm right.
Well, I always mean to go out anyway. Waking up's my trouble.
My trouble's waking up my old man. Honestly, our married life's one long row. It's nothing but trouble morning and night.
Why morning and night?
Getting him up to go to work and waking him up to go to bed.
Well, I can't see how your life can be one long row, then.
Well, it is.
But he's asleep most of the time.
Yes, and you should hear the row. Mind you, it's always the same. When you're caught in, he's so much in love, he can't sleep. And you think he's the man of your dreams.
And afterward?
Marriage opens your eyes and closes his.
Well, I'm jolly glad I'm a bachelor.
I was only joking.
I know you were, really.
It's time you found yourself a wife.
Well, I don't see why. I sleep like a top.
It's a mistake to leave it too late.
Why is it?
A young bachelor marries his choice. An old bachelor marries his housekeeper.
Well, I've got plenty of time yet.
Yes, of course you have. I suppose you haven't found yourself a young lady.
No, I'm afraid not.
There's only one thing for it. You'll have to fall back on one of your old flames.
Oh, no, look, we've been through this before.
Through what?
Old flames are out. I mean...
It'd be better than not having a young lady.
No, not for me, it wouldn't.
Why?
Well, I'm just not interested in old ladies. In old flames. Besides, the right person will come along sooner or later. I'm in no hurry.
Neither she, by the look of it. You might not meet her for ages.
Oh, I might have met her already, for all you know. For all I know, come to that. That's the awful thing.
What on earth are you talking about?
It's all a matter of fate. I mean, you know that somewhere in the world there's somebody who's absolutely right for you. But you can't be sure when you'll meet her, or how, or where, or anything. On the other hand, you might meet her and then, well, never see her again.
What's she like?
Who?
The girl you met in the park Monday.
Gosh, how on earth did you know?
You've been out early every morning this week. Besides, you're as good as told me. Was it love at first sight?
First and last. I haven't seen her again. I doubt if I ever will.
Oh, you never know. Did you speak to her?
Only for a second. Oh, she was so wonderfully gay. Even her eyes seemed to be dancing.
In step, I hope.
Oh, no, but... Seriously, she was.
Blonde or brunette?
Well, auburn.
Short or tall?
Just right.
Nice figure?
Well, yes, I suppose so.
You're not sure?
Well, of course I'm sure, only... Well, I didn't notice all that much.
A bit on the skinny side, eh?
Well, I say, steady on.
What was she doing in the park?
Well, taking her dog for a walk.
What's the matter with her?
Love at first sight. Oh, well, I must be on my way. I'll see you tomorrow.
Yes, all right. Have a nice time tonight.
Tonight?
You're going round to your sister's.
Oh, yes, so I am.
I don't know what you'd do without them now you haven't got a young lady.
I know. Still, never mind, something's bound to turn up before long.
Something or somebody?
When my somebody turns up, she'll really be something. I wonder if I will see her again. Anne?
Who's that?
Oh, it's all right. It's only me.
Oh, hello, Poppet. How did you get in?
Oh, Tony gave me his key.
Leave the door, then.
He's just putting the car away for the night.
I've just been putting the children away.
It sounds as if you've murdered them.
Believe me, it was touch and go with Carol. Oh, there's Tony now.
Darling?
Yes?
Will you go and kiss Carol goodnight?
Oh, all right.
Oh, and Tony?
What?
Alexander's asleep, so don't make a noise.
Oh, no, I've had a hard day's work.
That's what I mean. Take it quietly.
I've never known a baby cry less than Alexander.
I've never known a baby cry louder.
Well, I've never heard him.
Well, no. You wouldn't where you live. They do say... They do say the reception's quite good 3 doors away. You know, it's time you settled down and had a family, Poppet. We must think of some nice girl for you.
Oh, gosh, don't you start. I've had enough of that with Mrs. Griffin.
Don't worry, I wasn't serious.
No, I know you weren't.
I know who'd be perfect for you. Pauline Massey.
Pauline Massey?
You must have met her, Helen Massey's sister. About 24, awfully pretty. She's the perfect wife for you.
Will I be allowed to see her before I decide?
Yes, of course. I know. I'll give her a ring now.
Oh, no, please. No, I was only joking.
Only joking about what?
He's terrified I'm going to marry him off to Pauline Massey.
He's quite right to be terrified. It's a hobby with women.
What is?
Marrying people off.
Now, don't be so silly. Why should we bother about other people? We have enough trouble getting ourselves married.
Ah, now that's very interesting. So you admit you had trouble in finding a husband?
No, in choosing one out of the many. I'm not sure I made the right choice even now.
Women love to have a hand in arranging a marriage.
Well, I can't think why we do.
For the very same reasons you keep shifting the furniture around just for the fun of arranging it.
Now, you'll have David taking you seriously. Did you put Carol's light out?
Oh, no. She wants a drink of water.
All right, I'll see to it. You sit down. You must be tired.
Yes, I am, rather. I've had a pretty tiring. Where's my chair?
Over there.
What are you doing over there?
I had to arrange something, and I haven't arranged a marriage in months.
Have you ever met her, Tony?
Who, Pauline Massey? Once, twice.
What's she like?
I can't remember her clearly. So she's obviously not attractive, not to me anyway. You may disagree when you meet her.
If I ever do.
Oh, you'll meet her all right. Anne'll arrange that.
Oh, she wasn't serious. not that there'd be any harm in just meeting her.
Oh, my dear chap, famous last words.
Oh, gracious, Tony, but she can't marry me without my consent. After all, Anne's my sister. She wouldn't want me to marry unless I was going to be happy.
My dear fellow, women don't tackle it from that angle at all. You've only got to listen to them talking at a wedding to know that. They don't say, I think she'll make him awfully happy.
No?
No. They say, I think she'll be awfully good for him.
what would you do if you were me?
I'd stop it before it started. By saying she wasn't my type.
Oh, how can I say that when I haven't met her?
Well, pretend you have.
I told Anne I hadn't.
Well, you suddenly remembered you have met her after all.
Well, I suppose I could say that.
Yeah.
But mind you, I still think that...
Now, perhaps I can sit down for a few seconds. What were we talking about?
I have met her, actually.
Met who?
Pauline Massey.
Have you?
Yes, I suddenly remembered.
When?
Just now.
When did you meet her?
Oh, sorry, no, I don't remember exactly.
Where?
I don't remember that either. I've got a shocking memory.
It wasn't here, was it?
Yes, of course it was.
I don't remember.
It must run in the family.
Anyway, did you like her?
Oh, she's not really my type.
Not your type?
Well, no.
Why not?
Well, you can't explain why someone isn't your type.
Well, she just isn't, that's all. So you see, there wouldn't be any point in it.
In what?
In me marrying her. Meeting her. And me meeting her again, I mean.
You wouldn't by any chance be saying all this just... Oh, now, who on earth can that be? All right, I'll go.
Yeah, I'll go.
I'm up now.
Oh, good.
Oh, you're impossible.
Gosh, I jolly nearly gave myself away.
Yeah.
Still, even if I did it, it must be pretty obvious I don't want to meet Pauline Massey.
Pauline, darling.
Pauline.
Well, we all have to do things we don't want to do.
You don't think Anne planned all this, do you? I mean, her coming round and everything.
I haven't been a best man for ages.
Tony, what on earth do I say now? I mean, I'm supposed to have met her.
Stick to your story. She'll think she's got a bad memory.
In here, it's Pauline Massey, darling.
Hello there.
Hello.
This is my brother, David.
I think we've met, actually.
Yes, we have.
We have? When? Oh, I mean, I can't remember exactly when it was.
At my sister's party.
Oh, yes, of course. Gosh, you know, that's incredible.
What?
That we have met, after all. After all these years.
It was only last month.
Oh, yes, wasn't it? Well, I have no idea of time.
Pauline wants to use the phone, darling.
Oh, right, it's in the other room. I'll show it away.
Thank you. I'm sorry to do this, but it happens to be awfully important.
Honestly, Anne, I'm surprised at you, arranging for her to come round like this.
I hadn't the faintest idea she was coming.
Oh, you'll never convince me it was just a coincidence.
Do you know who she's phoning? Her fiancé.
Her fiancé?
That's why she came round, to tell me the glad news.
I'm convinced.
You know, you shouldn't listen to Tony, you know. All that nonsense about marrying people off, I'm not a bit like that.
Well, I'm sure you're not, really. I say, fancy her getting engaged.
Yes, I know. We'll have to find somebody else for you.
I don't... I don't want anybody else. Well, at least I do, only when I...
What?
The right person will come along sooner or later. There we are. Home again. Go on, then. In you go.
I thought I heard the door.
Oh, hello, Mrs. Griffin. We've been for a walk in the park.
Any luck?
No.
Oh, dear, that's nearly a fortnight now. I should give it up as a bad job. I mean, you can't spend the rest of your life looking for her.
Oh, I don't know. It's a jolly healthy life. Oh, gracious, who can that be at this time of the morning? Oh, all right, I'll go.
I must get on.
Oh, take Psyche with you.
Yes, all right.
Okay, coming. Oh, hello, Tony. What brings you out so early?
I've got some bad news for you. Huh? Anne and your mother have joined forces and found you another girlfriend.
Oh, gosh, who is it this time?
Penny Day or Gay, something like that, anyway.
Do you know her?
No, but your mother practically admitted she was very dull. Not in those words, of course.
Why? What did she say?
Very suitable. David, you doing anything on Sunday?
Well, I can't think of anything offhand.
I should think pretty quick, then. That's when you're going to meet her.
Well,
down at your mother's.
No, no, look, this is ridiculous. I shall just say I don't want to meet her.
You can't say that. You're not supposed to know she's going to be there.
I just don't believe it. I mean, they wouldn't play a trick like that on me.
They would, you know, and without the slightest twinge of conscience. Women always have the perfect excuse.
What's that?
It's for your own good. If you'll take my advice, you'll play safe and say you've been invited away for the weekend.
Well, I think perhaps I will. Well, it was jolly nice of you to warn me, Tony.
Oh, my dear chap. Besides, it isn't entirely unselfish. If you get out of it, we probably won't have to go.
Well, don't you want to?
Well, I just don't want it to become too much of a habit. Oh, I'm very fond of your old man, of course, but, well, we just don't speak the same language. He talks about horses and shooting and fishing. Oh, bless his old heart, he can be a bit of a bore, you know. He's the only man I know who can tell you about the one that got away and still not see the joke. Look, if that's Anne, for heaven's sake, don't say I'm here. She'd guess in a second.
Oh, right. Hello?
Oh, hello, Poppet. Anne.
Oh, hello, Anne.
Are you rushing off to the office?
Oh, not for a second.
I don't know what was the matter with Tony this morning. He went off terribly early.
I know.
You know?
No, I know how busy he is. I'll have to go fairly soon, actually.
All right, I won't keep you then. Now, are you doing anything on Sunday?
Oh, well, yes. I've been invited away for the weekend.
Oh, have you? Who by?
Who by?
Yes.
Oh.
Oh, now, for goodness sake, David, you must remember who you're staying with.
Yes, I know. I'll think of someone in a minute. Eric Holmes.
I see.
I'd love to have come otherwise.
Come where?
Down to Mother's.
Who said anything about going down to Mother's?
Well, you did.
I didn't.
I wonder where I got it from, then.
There were only three people, you know. Mother and I and Tony. It certainly wasn't me, and it can't have been Mother.
Why?
She asked me to ring you.
Well, did she?
Yes, yeah, she did.
Oh, well, that's thinned it out a bit.
Oh, now, don't be silly, David. You might just as well admit it was Tony.
Oh, I could have guessed, you know. After all, we go down there fairly often.
That's true. I'm afraid Mother will be awfully disappointed. Still, I'll explain for you.
Well, thank you. Look, I must go now, Anne.
Yes, all right. Oh, David.
Yes?
Put Tony on for a second.
Yes, of course. Hold up.
I thought as much.
Oh, dear.
So he came round to warn you.
Well, no, he...
Shall I put him on?
No. I'll speak to him later. I couldn't be more angry, David.
Well, I'm sorry, but I...
I'll see you on Sunday. Goodbye.
Oh, gosh.
Of all the blithering idiots. I couldn't be more angry, David. Out of the kindness of my heart, I come around here to warn you, and all you do is to land me in trouble.
Sorry.
I should think so, too. I'd better go before I say something I'll regret. I'll say this, though. If you can't cope better than that, you deserve anything you get. Even a wife.
Oh, dear.
Who was that? Your brother-in-law?
Yes.
What's the matter? You look as if you'd lost something.
On the contrary, I've got something I don't want. Mother's found me a girlfriend.
Oh, I am pleased.
But I don't want anybody to find my girlfriends for me. I'll find my own.
Oh, I'll believe that when I see her.
Hello, Father.
Hello, David. Come along in. I'm just telling Tony about a fish that got away the other afternoon.
Why? What happened?
Oh, I won't bore you with it. It's a long story.
About that long?
Longer than that.
Where is everybody?
Ben and your mother are getting the tea ready, I think.
Well, what time's Penny Gay coming?
Any minute now, I expect.
Oh, do you know her, Father?
No, I've known her since she was no bigger than that. Used to bounce her on my knee. Haven't seen her lately, though.
One of the ones that got away.
What's she like now?
Oh, she's a pretty little thing. Your mother thinks a lot of her. She's always saying she'll make her somebody a good wife.
Dum, 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 dum.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
Tony's right. You don't want to let mother choose your wife for you. Women haven't the foggiest notion what men find attractive.
I thought you said she was pretty.
Well, being pretty is not enough. A girl's got to have that spark, that fire, that... Oh, you can't put it into words, really.
No, you need exclamation marks.
that indefinable something that makes the old heart thump.
Yes, and the old eyes pop.
doesn't a pretty girl do all that?
Bless my heart, David. A pretty woman's like, well, like a beautiful meal. It's nice to have all the trimmings, but it's still no good if it's cold.
Far better to settle for something plain but hot.
Yes. Yes, or a continental dish. What?
I couldn't agree more.
I am surprised, aren't you?
Why?
Well, for agreeing.
Well, of course I agree. I mean, there's nothing worse than cold food.
David, old boy, we were talking about women.
Yes, I know, but then you started talking about food. You said you liked it hot.
Yeah. Hot, meaning, well,
Gosh, I see. No, but seriously, though, there's nothing worse than cold food.
On second thoughts, perhaps it's a good idea to let Mother find your wife.
Why?
Well, she's bound to choose a good cook.
I wish to goodness I'd got a girlfriend. It's caused nothing but trouble. Trouble with Anne, trouble with Tony.
Oh, that's all over and forgotten.
Yes, I know, but I still feel guilty about it. Oh, after all, it's my fault you had to come down here.
Had to come?
I had to come down here and make polite conversation to Penny instead of chatting to you.
Oh, well, of course, if it's causing all that trouble, and I do see your point, why not invent a girlfriend?
Well, how do you mean?
Well, say you found one after all. That'd keep Anne and Mother at bay.
Gosh, you know, that's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
Oh, but then I'd have told Anne about her when she suggested meeting Penny.
Oh, but that was 3 or 4 days ago. Anything could have happened since then. Yes, well, wait a minute. You'll need to have a pretty complete picture of her, though.
Yes, I know.
Now, what sort of girl would she be? Now, let's think.
Well, it's no good you or me thinking. Let David think. Blonde or brunette, David?
Well, auburn, really.
Tall or short?
Just right.
Age?
About 20, I should think. Eyes, brown, complexion, beautiful. With a wonderfully gay personality.
A nice figure to round it off, eh?
Well, yes. Yes, jolly nice, and not a bit skinny either.
I say, what an imagination.
I didn't know you had it in you. Right, now we'll give her a name. And where's the telephone, Rachel?
What?
Oh, yes, there they are. You know, I'm enjoying this. Now, do you think she's an A to D?
Oh, it could be.
I tell you what, I'll open it at random and that'll be it. Ready?
Huh?
Right, from henceforth she shall be known as... I can't read it without my glasses. What's the first one, David?
African.
African?
Odd name.
All right, I'll have another shot. Now, there we are.
Alan.
What about a Christian name?
Monica.
I see, that was quick.
Why a terrible name like Monica? I don't know, it just seems to fit. Monica Allen. All right, she's your figment. My what? Figment of your imagination. Oh, she's not actually. She's real. I saw her in the park one morning. And you let one like that get away? Why, you're worse than your father. I've been there every day. Oh, hello, Mother.
Hello, dear. Tea'll be ready soon.
Good show.
What have you been talking about?
Well, David's been telling us about his latest. Haven't you, David?
Yeah. Yes, I have.
Latest what?
Figment. latest girlfriend.
You haven't got a girlfriend.
Oh, I have. I met her about a fortnight, four days ago.
Yeah. She sounds a smasher.
Then I probably won't approve.
Why, ever not? You were a smasher, you know.
Thank you, dear. And you were quite a stunner yourself. What's her name, David?
African. Alan. Monica Allen.
What on earth made you say African?
Oh, well, she comes from South Africa. Oh, Monica. Yes, she does.
Is she nice?
Wonderful.
You wait till you see Penny. You'll think she's even more wonderful.
I doubt if you will, you know. It's pretty serious, isn't it, David?
Oh, yes. Yes, it is.
But that you've only known her a few days.
It was love at first sight.
Yes, well, I shouldn't do anything about it yet. It's a mistake to rush these things.
Nonsense. We were married 3 weeks after we met.
Yes, that's what I mean. It's a mistake. Where did you meet her, David?
In the park.
In the park?
Yes, I was out with Psyche and she was taking her dog for a walk. She was absolutely wonderful.
When are you seeing her again?
I doubt if I ever will. Ever will meet anyone I could love as much.
Are you sure?
Oh, pretty sure.
David, my dear, how exciting. I couldn't be more pleased.
Hello, then. What's she so excited about? Oh, I haven't the vaguest idea. Psyche.
In here. Here's Penny, Mother.
Oh, hello, dear. I didn't hear the door.
No, it was open. I saw Anne in the garden.
I'll go and make the tea.
Thank you, dear. You know Father, of course.
Oh, yes.
Hello there.
Hello.
Anne's husband, Tony.
How do you do?
And my son, David.
How do you do?
How do you do? I'm sure you won't remember, but we have met.
Yes, in the park about a fortnight ago.
Gosh, you do remember.
You must spend your life in the park, David.
Well, I have recently. I haven't seen you there, though.
Well, no. I always mean to take Tug out, but I never wake up.
What sort of dog have you got, Penny?
Well, he's a wire-haired terrier, too.
Yes, I know. You didn't bring him.
No, he's at home.
Psyche hasn't looked at another dog since.
I don't believe it.
Well, it's true. Come to that, neither have I.
What?
Looked at another dog. Looked at another girl since.
Since you met Monica?
No, since I met... Oh, yes. Since I met Monica.
David's got the most exciting news. He's getting engaged.
Oh, no, look, I didn't say that.
Oh, you did, David.
Well, I'm not, anyway. I mean, not now. I mean, not till I'm absolutely sure.
But you said you were sure.
Oh, but it's a mistake to rush these things.
Nonsense. Your father and I were married 3 weeks after we met.
Yes, I know, but, well, I might meet someone I liked even more.
Now, you said you never would.
Did I?
Yes.
I've been talking too much.
Oh, for goodness sake, David. Penny will wonder what's the matter with you. David's always been so terribly shy.
No, it isn't that, really.
Of course it is. Before Penny came, it was nothing but Monica. You know that's true.
Yes, it's true.
I must say, I'm not awfully fond of the name Monica.
Well, neither am I. I can't think why I chose it. Why parents chose it. Mind you, they do go together quite well. Monica Allen.
Monica Allen?
Yes.
I thought she was married.
Who?
Monica.
Oh, good heavens.
What?
Well, don't tell me there is one. I mean, there is one person who knows her.
I went to school with her.
Gosh, what a coincidence.
Tea's all ready, Mother.
Oh, right. Come along, everybody. It's in the other room.
Tony.
What?
It's her. It's the one I met in the park.
Yes, so I gathered.
What on earth can I do?
Well, there's not much you can do. You've got yourself in a real mess, haven't you?
Yes, but it was your idea.
Yes, I know, and look how well it worked. Oh, coming. Oh. Good morning, Mrs. Griffin.
Sorry, I left my key behind.
Oh, that's all right.
Here, do you know what they're saying about you?
What?
They're saying you're going round with a married woman.
going around with... I'm not going around with anyone.
That's what they're saying.
Well, you don't believe it.
Of course I don't believe it. I know you far too well for that. Besides, I got it from my next-door neighbour.
Oh, but it's fantastic.
She did tell me the name of the woman now, Monica Graham.
Well, there you are. I've never even heard of... Monica Allen?
No, Graham. Monica Allen's that girl you used to know years ago. You know, when I first came here with you.
Oh, gosh, no wonder it fitted. How on earth did your next-door neighbour hear about it?
From her next-door neighbour.
Yes, but where did she get it from?
Oh, do you really want me to go on? It's ever such a long street.
Honestly, you know, it's true. Trouble never do come singly.
I shouldn't worry about it if I was you. What's the matter with Psyche? She's left her breakfast.
She's one of my troubles. I don't know whether she's sulking because I haven't taken her for a walk or whether it's love.
Oh, you are daft about that dog. There's the front door now.
No, all right, I'll go. Oh, hello, Mother. I didn't know you were coming up today.
Anne and I are going shopping.
Well, jolly early.
Yes, I know. I wanted to catch you before you left for the office.
Why?
I was wondering if you'd like to have lunch with us.
Well, it's jolly nice of you.
You and your fiancé.
My fiancé? Monica? Oh, no, I'm afraid Monica can't come. She's having lunch with somebody else.
Well, how about tea, then?
She's booked up all day.
Oh, dear, what a shame. Still, never mind. I'll be coming up again next week. I'm longing to see her, David.
Yes, I'm sure you are.
Father's coming up with me so we can all have lunch together.
Well, I'm awfully sorry, Mother, but she's booked up that day, too.
Well, we're not sure which day we're coming.
She's not sure when she's booked up. I mean... excuse me. Hello?
Bliss?
Oh, yes?
Graham here. Monica Graham's husband.
Oh, dear.
What's this ridiculous rumor about you seeing my wife?
Oh, that's just what it is. Ridiculous.
I know that, but I gather you started it.
You started what?
All this nonsense about her.
Oh, no, you're wrong. Honestly, you are. I haven't started any nonsense with her.
What?
About her.
You'd better stop anyway, otherwise there'll be trouble. Understand?
Well, I'm terribly sorry, but I Oh, gosh, she's gone. Oh, sorry, Mother. What were we talking about?
Your fiancé.
Oh, yes, of course.
Who was that?
Her husband.
Surprised at you, Dave.
No, look, there's nothing to it, honestly.
All right, I'll go.
I know what people are saying, but it's just...
Just a figment of their imagination.
Well, yes, that's exactly what... You know?
I've known all along, really.
It's your sister.
Hello, Poppet.
Oh, hello, Anne.
Look, how long before you have to go to the office?
Oh, about 10 minutes. Why?
If you rush along to the park, you'll see something to your advantage.
See something to my advantage.
I was on the phone to Penny a few moments ago. She said she was going to take Tug for a walk.
But how am I going to explain to her?
You don't have to explain anything. It's all been arranged.
What? By you?
You know what we women are.
Oh, gosh, thank you, Anne. Oh, come on, Psyche. Bless you both. Come along then, Psyche. Oh, look, there she is. Oh, and there's Tug. Go on then. Good morning.
Hello. Isn't it a lovely morning?
Oh, it's a perfect morning. Gosh, it's jolly nice to see you again.
It's nice to see you.
You know, I wouldn't dream of admitting I'd run after a girl, but, well, I don't mind admitting that as far as you're concerned, I...
You what?
I've put in a lot of walking.
You've been listening to A Life of Bliss. Those taking part were David Bliss, George Cole, Anne Fellows, Diana Churchill, Tony Fellows, Colin Gordon. Mrs. Bliss, Gladys Young, Mr. Bliss, Ernest Jay, Mrs. Griffin, Gladys Henson, Penny Gay, Petula Clark, Psyche the Dog, Percy Edwards, The Neighbour, Elsa Palmer, Pauline Massey, Ruth Trouncer. With the BBC Variety Orchestra conducted by Paul Fenelay, with music scored by Bob Sharples. The script was written by Godfrey Harrison, and this recorded programme was produced by Leslie Bridgemont.
hope you enjoyed our second show. Until next time, thank you for listening.